Hello students, welcome to the Champion series, and today you are going to cover the chapter liquid solutions in this series. I am your Anushka ma'am and we are going to cover this one shot session. So my dear students, whenever we talk about solutions, what is the first thought that comes in your mind? Ma'am, solutions, it means it will be something in liquid state, yes. But my dear students, we are going to understand the various concepts of solutions, what all components are present in a solution. It is not only one liquid which gives you a solution. You have various other components as well. How many components are there? Ma'am, can it only be two? Can it only be three? We are going to discuss all about it today. Okay, my dear students, so let us start this amazing session. Now, whenever we talk about solutions, we are going to cover solutions. Okay. So the first thought, what is a solution? My dear students, solutions can be described into two basic factors. It can be a homogeneous solution or it can be heterogeneous solution. What is the difference between homogeneous solution and heterogeneous solution? So let's first write it. Solutions it can be homogeneous solution and it can be heterogeneous solution. Okay, now whenever we talk about homogeneous solution, what is the basic picture that should come in your mind? Whenever you talk about homogeneous solution, my dear students, just think of sugar in water. You have mixed sugar in water. What it is? It is a solution, and my dear students, it is a homogeneous solution because it has uniform composition. It has uniform composition. What does uniform composition mean? You take any part of that solution, it will be same. For example, I have this let us say this is a sugar solution. Okay, and now I am just telling you that I have mixed sugar in this water solution, water solvent. And if you take this part, you take this part, or you take this part, you take out any point, any part of the solution, it will be exactly same. That is uniform composition. That is, it is evenly mixed. But whenever we talk about heterogeneous mixture, it does not have uniform composition. So you will say does not have uniform composition. Okay. Now let's think about it. Non-uniform composition means, what does this mean? Let's think about it. Take water again. You'll take water. And this time, just add sand in it. What are you adding? Sand. Okay. So, ma'am, I have water plus sand. Okay. Now, you know that sand cannot be mixed in water. Yes, ma'am, we know that sand cannot be mixed in water. So, it will settle down here. Now, the same way you did here, you have to do here as well. Take different parts of this liquid solution. Okay, so I'll take one part from here and I'll take one part from here. What can you see? Are the two different parts from where you took the solution same? Are their compositions same? No. This composition, this part does not have sand in it, but here it has sand in it. So the ma'am, the composition has changed. This is a heterogeneous mixture. This is a heterogeneous mixture and it does not have a uniform composition. Whereas in a homogeneous solution, it has uniform composition. So this is the basic difference between homogeneous solutions and heterogeneous solutions. A solution is a homogeneous mixture of two or more than two components. Ma'am, why are you saying here that it is only a homogeneous mixture? It can be a heterogeneous mixture as well. Yes, my dear students, you are absolutely right. And that is the reason I am telling you that in this particular chapter, we are only and only going to study about homogeneous solutions. That is even composition, uniform composition. Okay. Okay, ma'am, homogeneous and heterogeneous, we have understood. Now let's move forward. What is next? माई डियर स्टूडेंट्स, नेक्स्ट इज दैट हाउ मेनी कॉम्पोनेंट्स अ सोल्यूशन कैन हैव. कैन इट ओनली हैव वन सॉल्वेंट एंड वन सोल्यूट, और इट कैन हैव मेनी अदर कॉम्पोनेंट्स? तो वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट दैट. Whenever I tell you about, let us say, I told you that you have water, yes, and you added sugar to it, yes ma'am. When you added sugar to it, water will be your solvent and sugar will be your solute. How did you classify it, one as a solute and one as a solvent? Let us answer this question first. Whenever you talk about solvent, the component which has the maximum moles is regarded as a solvent. If in a solution you have two components and one component has 5 moles and the other component is in 10 moles, then my dear students, that 10 mole component will be considered as your solvent. So let us write this. This is very important, that a solution has two components, has not only two components, it can have many components, my dear students. A solution will have solvent and it will have solute. Okay, now let's talk about solvent. Out of all the components, the component which has the maximum number of moles, that will be considered as your solvent. Okay, so we'll write that maximum number of moles of the components present is regarded as solvent. Okay, and whenever you talk about solute, then all the other components are regarded as solute. So from here you got an answer as well. Can you have only one solvent? Can you have only one solute? No, my dear students, you can have many components, first thing, and the second thing is you can have many solutes. It can be 2, 3, 4, 1, anything, but you can only and only have one solvent. In a solution, there is only one solvent and one or more than one solute. This is the most important thing. For example, if I have water, I added sugar to it. Okay, ma'am, you added sugar to it. So water is your solvent because it is in a large amount, it is in more number of moles. So that is your solvent. When you added sugar to it, that was your solute. You added sugar to it, that was your solute. Now you are making lemonade. So what will happen? You have to add salt as well. Yes, ma'am. Then what is salt? Salt is also a solute. It cannot be a solvent. It is a solute. You cannot take 1 water, 2 water, 3 water, 4 water. But yes, you can take 1 solute, 2 solute, and 3 solutes. So always remember, in a solution, you can only have one solvent, but you can have more than one solute. Okay, so all in all, we can say that a solution can have many components, but it will only have one solvent and more than one solute or one as well. Okay, perfect. So this maximum number of moles of the components present in present is regarded as the solvent. Okay, and the others are regarded as, so we can write that other components of solution are regarded as solutes. Okay, perfect. We'll talk about it further. Next, components are here. It can have a solute as well as solvent. A solution has only one solvent. A solution can have only one solvent, but one or more than one solute. Okay, perfect. No issues. Very good. Now, let's move forward. Now, I told you that it can have more than one solute. So, it can have 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, how many components it wants. Okay. So, how do we classify the solution? We have to name the solutions now. How many components they have, they will be named according to that. Okay. It can be binary, it can be ternary, it can be quaternary. So, now we are going to talk about that. Now, let's discuss about this. In a solution, it will have a minimum one solvent. If it will not have solvent, then how are you going to mix anything, right? Yes. So, one solvent. Now, when you talk about salute, let's take the minimum part. It will have at least one salute. Only then you can say it as you can call it as a solution. Otherwise, it's only a solvent. Yes, ma'am. So it will have at least one salute. And now, if you see, you have total two components, right? One and one, two. Total two components. A solution with the total two components is regarded as a binary solution. So you will call it as a binary solution. Okay, perfect. Now let's talk about the other part. You'll have again one solvent. Yes, ma'am, one solvent. Now let us consider you have two solutes. Now you have two solutes. So now, ma'am, two solutes. So total, how many components, my dear students? Two plus one, three. And when you have three components in a solution, you call it as a ternary solution. Ternary solution. Okay. No issues? Perfect. Now let's talk about the third part. You have, again, you can have only one solvent. Yes, ma'am. Now, let us say you have three solutes. Now you have three solutes. So total, how many components? Four. So you will call it as a quaternary solution. Quaternary solution. Okay? Perfect. I can call it as 2, I can call it as 3, I can call it as 4, just add plus, plus and plus. Okay, perfect. So this is how you classify a solution. It is a binary solution, it is a ternary solution, it is a quaternary solution. And you know that you can only have one solvent, so the others would be your solute. Perfect. Now, if in the future questions or the topics which we are going to cover, if it is not mentioned that which solution it is, you are going to take it as a binary solution. And in most of the cases, we are only talking about the binary solutions in this chapter. Okay, until and unless it is mentioned to you. If nothing is mentioned, we can assume binary solution. No issues. Perfect. Let's move forward. Now, my dear students, it is calling you, it is telling you that whenever you talk about a solution, you have solvent and solute. The solvent is just a medium. It is only a medium, and the solute actually is the reactive part. What does this mean? I am going to tell you what does this mean. Imagine you have water. Yes, ma'am, I have water. You added sugar to it. So water was your solvent and you added the added sugar, which was your solute. Yes. What was the taste? It was sweet in taste. Yes, ma'am, perfect. Now, you took water again your solvent, and now instead of sugar, you added salt. Now again, water is your solvent and salt is your solute. When you added salt, what was the taste? It was salty. Yes, ma'am. It was not sweet. It was salty. The taste was different. Yes. In the two different parts, my dear students, solvent was exactly same. What changed? Ma'am, only the solute changed and the taste changed. So what can you say? We can say that the solute is actually the reactive part. That is the reactive part. Solute is the reactive part, and solvent is only and only providing a medium for the reactions or for the processes. Right? Yes. So I think you can understand this line now. Solute is the reactive part and solvent provides the medium for the reaction. Clear? Yes. If you are talking about aqueous NaOH solution, my dear students, here I would say that NaOH is the solute and it is a reactive part. It will take part in reaction, not your solvent. Here solvent is water, but it will not take part in reaction. Actual the reaction would take place between by NaOH, which is your solute. I'll give you more examples. We'll move forward slowly and slowly. Okay. Next, the amount of solute in a solution is represented by the concentration of the solution. Now, my dear students, I just want to give you an example. Imagine you are talking about me. Okay, if you are talking about a person and you want to know their height, they can tell you their height in different ways. N number of ways they can give you your heights, right? It can be in centimeters. It can be in meters, it can be in nanometers, it can be in feet. Yes, everybody tells their age, heights in different lengths. Yes, ma'am. Units. Yes. So, my dear students, Does their height as also change? If they are talking about their height in centimeter, it will be some different number. If they are talking about their height in nanometers, it would be some different value. If they are talking about their height in feet, it would be some different value. But the person is same, right? Yes. And his or her height is also same. Yes, ma'am. So we can say that it is only the units which are changing, but actual height is not changing. So these are different ways of telling the height of the same person. Same way, my dear students, concentration, this concentration term is only and only a way of defining a particular solution. Imagine you have this solution. Imagine you have this solution. Just a second. Yeah. Imagine I'll talk to you about here. Okay. Imagine you have the solution and I am telling you that you added 1 mole NaOH and here it is water, okay, in let us say 1 liter water, okay. Now, how can you talk about it? You can say that you added 1 mole NaOH in 1 liter water, right? Yes. Or how can you say? You can say that you added 1 mole NaOH in 1000 milliliter water. Yes, ma'am. Or 1 mole of NaOH. What is the weight of 1 mole of NaOH? 40 grams. Yes, ma'am. So you can say that 40 grams NaOH is present in, let us say, 1 liter H2O. So all these three things are telling you about the same solution, right? Yes, but these three can be regarded as a different concentration terms. Here you are talking moles of solute per liter of water, or you can say moles of NaOH per milliliter of water, per 1000 milliliter of water, right? Or you can say that grams of NaOH present per liter of solution. So what are you doing? You are just taking different units, but you're talking about the same solution. So concentration terms are actually just the way of expressing the concentration, the different forms of concentrations of solutions. It is nothing different. If you are talking about the same solution, you can have n number of ways of defining its concentration. Okay. Yes, so now we are going to talk about the concentration terms and it is a very important part. Okay, perfect. I hope you understood it. It is the measure of amount of solute in the solution. Okay, perfect. Let's move forward. Now, the first concentration term is molarity and it is represented by capital M. Okay, what does molarity define? Ma'am, molarity means moles of solute present per liter of solution. That is, if you have 1 liter of solution, how many moles of solute are present? That is what it is, what is called as molarity. Okay, so it is the number of moles of solute present per liter of solution. If I tell you that I have 5 moles of solute in, let us say, 5 liters of solution. So what is its molarity? So you will say that we know that how many moles of your solute are present in 1 liter of solution. You have 5 liter of solution? Yes, ma'am. So what will you do? You will use the unitary method. You will say 5 liter solution contains 5 moles. So 1 liter solution will contain 1 mole. Right? Yes. So, ma'am, the molarity of the solution is 1. Yes or no? Yes. So, the basic idea is this. The basic idea is this. But you generally learn formulas. So, I don't want my students to just mug up the formulas. I want them to understand the logic behind it. So, now we can write the formula as well. Right? What can we say? That what is the molarity? Ma'am, molarity is... What did you do here? Ma'am, we divided the moles of solute to the moles volume of the solution in liters. So, the formula would be moles of solute divided by volume of solution in liters. Right? Yes. So, this is the formula. So, this is the formula. Clear? I hope there's no issue. यस परफेक्ट. तो मोलैरिटी इज मोल्स ऑफ सोल्यूट डिवाइडेड बाय द वॉल्यूम ऑफ सोल्यूशन एंड द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट इज इट शुड बी इन लीटर. ओके यस दिस इज द फर्स्ट पॉइंट अबाउट मोलैरिटी. नाउ लेट्स डिस्कस इट फर्दर. माय डियर स्टूडेंट्स इफ आई गिव यू अ पर्टिकुलर मोलर सोल्यूशन लेट अस से आई टोल्ड यू दैट यू हैव फाइव मोलर आई विल राइट इट विद राइट फाइव मोलर एन ए ओ एच सोल्यूशन. ठीक है, देर इज एक्वस सोल्यूशन. ओके यस हाउ आर वी गोइंग टू रीड इट, हाउ आर वी गोइंग टू इंटरप्रेट इट, दैट इज द मोस्ट इंपॉर्टेंट पार्ट. सो माई डियर स्टूडेंट्स फाइव मोलर एक्वस एन ओ एच सोल्यूशन मीन्स दैट यू हैव फाइव मोल्स ऑफ एन ए ओ एच विच इज योर सोल्यूट, फाइव मोल्स ऑफ एन ए ओ एच प्रेजेंट इन 1 liter of the solution. Now, this is the most important part and one more important thing, my dear students. Whenever it is given an aqueous solution, I'll write it here, okay? Aqueous solution. Whenever it is written that it is an aqueous solution, always remember, my dear students, aqueous means that your solvent is water. Aqueous means your solvent is water. It is giving you information that solvent is water. Okay. I'll give you more examples. Right? Example, I told you, you have an aqueous solution of NaOH. This means that you have solute NaOH and your solvent here is water. Your solvent is water. Again, one more example. I told you, you have an aqueous solution of H2SO4. Right? Yes. So, you will have solute. I can hear it. You just said H2SO4. Very good. So, solute is H2SO4. Right? Yes. And your solvent is water. And your solvent is, again, water. H2O. Easy? Yeah, ma'am. So, this is also very important because when you are going to read questions, they'll just give you aqueous solution. You have to find out that aqueous solution means solvent is water. Perfect. Now, we can move forward. Perfect. Now, ma'am, 5 molar aqueous NaOH solution means that you have 5 moles of NaOH present in 1 liter solution and here your solvent is water. Clear? Yes. Let me give you one more part too. You have 5 molar aqueous NaCl solution. This is my question to you. You have 5 molar aqueous NaCl solution with you. Give me the mass of NaCl present. Give me the mass of NaCl present in this solution. So, pause the video and just answer me the question. Okay? Yes. Okay, now let's see. I hope you did pause the video and you answered it. Ma'am, 5 molar NaCl solution means that I have 5 moles aqueous, okay, 5 moles NaCl in 1 liter solution. No issues, perfect. It means that, ma'am, my solute is NaCl. So, your solute is NaCl. Right, now let's find out the molar mass of NaCl. Okay, so ma'am, molar mass of NaCl is 23 plus 35.5, which is equal to 5678. 3 plus 2 is 558.5 grams per mole. Right? Yes. And how many moles do you have of your solute? I have 5 moles of solute. So, the mass present would be 1 moles mass is 58.5. 5 moles mass would be into 5. Yes, ma'am. So, 5 into 58.5. Easy. 5, 5, 25, 45, 25, 29. Just check it out. Okay. I can make mistakes with maths calculations. आर आउट ऑफ माई माइंड बट स्टिल ओके आई डू सिली मिस्टेक्स आई डू सिली मिस्टेक्स बट या यू हैव टू चेक आई डू अगेन ना 5 5 25 so 5 what did I do just a second now 5 into 30 which is 58.5 so 58.5 okay 5 5 25 so ma'am this is 5 and there it is 2 25 5 5 25 5 8 40 so ma'am 2 see I am next level I am next level so this is 5 this is 2 42 so here it will be 4 45 29 and 2.292.5 grams I guess yeah so this is your correct answer so this is how you're going to find out the masses and this is how you are going to interpret whenever you are given the molarity of a particular solution okay perfect let's move forward it is the number okay we'll do questions as well don't worry we'll do questions as well at the end of the concentration terms okay so the next concept is your molality next is molality you have m molality okay which is denoted by small m what does molality stand for ma'am molality stands for the moles of solute which are present in 1 kg of solvent moles of solute present in 1 kg of solvent okay It is the number of moles of solute present per kg of solvent. Very important, my dear students. There it was 1 liter of solution. Moles of solute present in 1 liter of solution. Here it is moles of solute present in 1 kg of solvent. Okay? Yes. So, now we can write the formula. Now we can write the formula because we have got the idea how to write the formula. Right? Yes. So, ma'am, it will be moles of solute. It will be moles of solute divided by mass of solvent but in kg mass of solvent and that too in kg okay my dear students so this would be your formula for molality this would be your formula for molality no issues no issues very good if you got this I am giving you a particular type of molal solution okay and you are going to tell me that how are you going to interpret it okay perfect now if I tell you that you have 10 molal aqueous NaCl solution okay this is your question how are you going to interpret it let's interpret it okay ma'am 10 molal means I have 10 moles NaCl present in 1 kg solution or solvent 1 kg solvent 1 kg solvent and what is your solvent here I know that my solvent is water why it is written here aqueous so I can say that 1 kg solvent or water clear yes very good perfect now my dear students if I ask you what is the total mass of the solution what is the total mass of the solution here so what you are going to do that is very important whenever you talk about a solution there are two components we are talking about binary solutions so solution has solute and solvent yes ma'am so mass of solution will always be equal to mass of solute plus mass of solvent yes ma'am so mass of solute plus mass of solvent right this is very important you're going to use it in n number of ways in various numericals you are supposed to use this concept now use this concept and give me the total mass of the solution what is the total mass of the solution okay so ma'am if I see here I have 10 moles of NaCl and I have 1 kg of solvent so I can say that here I have mass of solute 10 into NaCl NaCl's mass we just calculated 58.5 so So this is 58.5, which is 585 grams, right? Yes. So this is the mass of your solute. Now let's calculate the mass of solvent. Mass of solvent is 1 kg. 1 kg means, ma'am, 1000 grams, right? So what will be the mass of solution? Add the two, 1000 plus 58.5, which is 1058.5 grams. So this will be the total mass of your solution. Okay, my dear students? Yes. This is how you are going to interpret. This is how you are going to use the concepts and try to solve the questions. We'll do n number of questions, but right now, first we'll understand all the concentration terms. Okay. So these two major concentration terms were very important. You are asked the questions of converting one form of concentration term to other as well. Right? Yes. So you should know that as well. We'll discuss about that in the future lecture. Next, my dear students. Next is your mass by volume percentage, or you can call it as volume percentage as well. But it's better if you call it only and only as mass by volume percentage. What is mass by volume percentage? It will give you first and the most important thing, percentage. Percentage means per 100. Per 100, yani ki, it means that you are talking about something out of 100. Okay? Yes. So, if you are given mass by volume percentage, it means that how many grams of your solute is present in, how many grams of your solute is present in 100 ml of your solution, 100 ml of your solution. Okay, so first and the most important thing, it is the grams of solute present per 100 milliliter of solution. The most important thing is here the volume is in milliliters and not liters, and the mass will always be in grams. Okay, right. So how are we going to write the formula for it? Mass by volume percentage will be equal to how much mass of your solute is present per 100 milliliter of solution. Yes, so the formula would be mass of solute in grams. Mass of solute in grams present in volume of solution in milliliters. Volume of solution in milliliters into 100 into 100. Why? Because we are talking about everything in 100, out of 100. So this will be the formula for your mass by volume percentage. Okay. Perfect. Now, again, we are going to interpret it. I'm not going to leave you like this. So now, if I ask you to interpret this, you have 10% mass by volume aqueous H2SO4 solution. So how are you going to interpret it? Ma'am, 10% mass by volume means that I have 10 grams of solute. Solute is H2SO4. So I have 10 grams of H2SO4 present in 100 ml of your solution. So 100 ml of solution. Okay. So this is how you are going to interpret this. Perfect. Let's move forward. Next, what is next? Next is mass by mass percentage. If you got mass by volume percent, then you can write it as well. Pause the video, write the formula yourself, and then I'll give you one particular point. I'll give you here first 20% mass by mass NaOH solution. Okay. Aqueous NaOH solution. So now you have to interpret it as well. Write the formula yourself and then start the video and see what I did. Okay. Perfect. Chalo. Let's start. Now it is the grams of solute present per 100 grams of solution. Yes, ma'am. Mass by mass would be this. Next, my dear students, if I give you the formula, then mass by mass percent would be equal to mass of solute divided by mass of solution into 100, mass of solution into 100. This will be the formula, right? I hope all of you would have found this yourself very well. How are you going to interpret this? Now let's interpret this, okay? Yeah. 20% mass by mass means that I have 20 grams of solute. What is my solute? NaOH. So 20 grams of NaOH is present in 100 grams of your solution. Is present in 100 grams of solution. Right? Yes. So this is how you are going to interpret this. Perfect. So ma'am, we got this. Perfect. Very good. Let's move forward. What is next? Next is volume by volume percentage or volume percent. Okay. Easy. Very easy. We can write the formula. Yes, ma'am. It is the milliliters of solute present per 100 milliliter of the solution. Okay. So first we are going to write the formula. Volume by volume percentage would be volume of solute. My dear students, this time your solute is also in liquid state and your solvent is also in liquid state, right? Yes. So volume of solution, this will be in milliliters, this would be in grams into 100. Okay. Yes. Oh, not grams. Wait. This will be also in milliliters. Okay. So this is what it is. Very easy. Perfect. Now let's interpret something. You have 10% volume by volume aqueous H2SO4 solution. How are you going to interpret it? Ma'am, 10 milliliters of H2SO4 is present in 100 milliliters of solution. Clear? This is how we are going to interpret it. Now, let us check one thing, my dear students. Here, let's write the formula, the units as well. This should be in grams, bacha, and this should be in milliliters. Okay? No. This is also mass. So, this should also be in grams. Okay? And here, this is in grams. This should be in milliliters. Perfect. Okay, we have done. Now, these were some of the concentration terms. Now, we are going to talk about a very, very important concentration term, which is going to be used in this particular chapter a lot. And that is mole fraction, right? Yes. So, we are going to talk about mole fraction. Ma'am, what is mole fraction? My dear students, the first thing which you should notice is fraction. If it is a fraction, its value will always and always be less than 1, right? Yes. So, it is a fraction, it will be less than 1. First and the most important thing, we got it. Next, my dear students, whenever you talk about mole fraction, what does it tell you? If you have a solution, let us say you have a solution and it has 5 components present in it. You are supposed to find out that, let us say you have a solution and I'll take 3 components. Let us say A, B and C. You know that, let us say it is present Na moles. You have A's Na moles present. You have B's Nb moles present. And you have C's Nc moles present. How many total moles are present in the solution? You say, ma'am, N total is Na plus Nb plus Nc. No issue. Yeah. I am very curious. I want to know that which particular component is in large amount, right? Which is the highest in amount and which is the least in amount? How are you going to find it? If you know that Na moles, Nb moles and Nc moles, so you can find their fractions present. Yes. How can you find the fractions present? If I want to find the fraction of A, then I would say that how many moles of A are present, that divided by total moles, I'll get the fraction of A. Yes. If I want fraction of B, I'll say moles of B present on total moles, I'll get the fraction of B. Right? Yes. So this is what is known as mole fraction. You are finding out the fraction of moles of a particular component. So every component have its individual mole fraction. Yes. What would be the formula, ma'am? It would be simply the moles of that particular component upon the total moles present, right? Yes. So the mole fraction is represented by a symbol which is chi. It is represented by the symbol chi. So if I talk about mole fraction, I can say that this is equal to moles of one component, moles of the component divided by total moles present. Total moles present. Right? Yeah. This will give you the mole fraction. Okay. So, this is a very important formula for you. Now, let's calculate the individual mole fractions of all the three components in this particular solution. If I ask you, mole fraction of A would be equal to moles of A upon total moles. So, ma'am, moles of A upon total moles. What are total moles? Moles of A plus moles of B plus moles of C. Right? Similarly, just calculate the mole fractions of B and C as well. Okay? So, mole fraction of B would be moles of B upon moles of A plus moles of B plus moles of C. Next would be mole fraction of C. Mole fraction of C would be moles of C upon moles of A plus moles of B plus moles of C. Right? Yes. So, these all three components will have their individual mole fractions. Right? Yes. So, this is how you calculate the mole fraction. Very easy. In a solution, we can calculate the mole fraction of all the components individually. Perfect. There's no issue. Now, my dear students, what I want to tell you is the most important thing. What is that most important thing? That add the mole fractions of all the components. Adding the mole fractions of all the components present in the solution. Adding mole fraction of all components present in solution. What will you get? Mole fraction of A plus mole fraction of B plus mole fraction of C. This would be moles of A upon, let us say this is N total. Moles of B, let us say this is N total. I am adding these, right? And this would be moles of C upon N total. Right? Yes. So, what can we say? Moles of A, since the denominator is the same. Total, total, total. So, denominator is same. So, we can add numerators. NB plus NC upon N total. What do you get? NA plus NB plus NC divided by NA plus NB plus NC, which is 1. So, this is the most important thing, that if you are adding the mole fraction of all the components present in a solution, the total sum of all the mole fractions will be equal to 1. If a solution has two components, then both of their mole fraction sum would be 1. If a solution consists of three components, then the sum of the mole fraction of all the three components would be 1. Okay, so this is how you are going to study this. Now, here we can say that mole fraction of A plus mole fraction of B plus mole fraction of C is equal to 1. Clear? Yes, very good. So, this is very important thing to notice, because you are going to use this concept a lot. Perfect. So, mole fraction, it is the fraction of total number of moles. Perfect. No issue. Next concentration terms is PPM. What does PPM stand for? PPM stands for the parts per million. Just the way you studied percent, the same way you are going to study parts per million. There you were finding everything out of 100. Because it was percent. This time you will be calculating everything out of million, because it is per million. Right? Yes. So, it is the number of grams of solute per 10 raised to the power 6 grams of the solution. Right? Yes. So, what would be the formula? PPM. Mass of solute divided by mass of solution. This will be in grams and this will be in grams into. This time you're not going to multiply by 100, because this is not percent. It is PPM, my dear students. So, you are going to multiply it by 10 raised to the power 6. Easy. Now, Similarly, if I give you 10 ppm NaCl, if I give you 10 ppm NaCl solution, how are you going to interpret it? Now let's interpret it. 10 ppm means that you have 10 grams of NaCl present in 10 raised to the power 6 grams of your solution. Okay, this is how you are going to interpret this. Perfect. So 10 grams of NaCl is present in 10 raised to the power 6 grams of your solution. Perfect. Very good. Now, similarly, if you are given PPB, do we have PPB? No. We have questions. We will do questions as well. The next concentration term, let us talk about PPB. What is PPB? It is 10 parts per billion. Billion means 10 raised to the power 9. So, you would say that formula for PPB would be mass of solute in grams present on mass of solution again in grams out of 10 raised to the power 9, because billion is 10 raised to the power 9. Now if you're going to interpret 10 ppb NaCl solution, this means that you have 10 grams of NaCl present in 10 raised to the power 9 grams of solution. Okay, yes, this is how you are going to interpret this particular part, right? Yes. So with this, we have come across all the concentration terms. But how are we supposed to solve the questions? That is the most important part. And now we are going to practice some questions. Okay, so let us start the practice session. Now, the first question is on your TV screens and you are supposed to pause the video and take the correct answer yourself. Okay, and then check out what ma'am did. Now, let's talk about the question. The increase in the temperature of aqueous solution will result in its molarity to increase, molarity to decrease, mole fraction to increase, mass percent to increase. Here, I want to tell you something very interesting, then you can solve this question, right? Whenever you increase the temperature, what are the factors that depend on temperature? My dear students, if you talk about mass or moles, these does not depend on temperature. These does not change with change in temperature. Okay. Yes. Is it like I am standing here and let us say my mass is some X grams and I am standing here and once I go into go outside where the temperature has increased and my mass would decrease or my mass would increase? No, ma'am. Your mass would remain same? Yes, bacha. So the mass would remain same. Yes. So mass does not depend on the change in the temperature. But volume. Does volume depend on temperature? Imagine you have a bowl full of water in this room, right? Yes, it has some V volume. Okay, clear. Whenever you will take this bowl outside and since the temperature has increased, the volume would decrease. Yes, ma'am. So we can say that volume is something which actually depends on the temperature. So you will say that volume depends on temperature. Okay. Now, if you are asked some question like this, that the increase in the temperature of the aqueous solution will result in, what will happen? Now let's talk about this. I know that, ma'am, as the temperature increases, volume decreases, but there's no effect on mass. Okay, the first concentration term that we are talking about is molarity. What is molarity? Molarity is moles divided by volume. Now, my dear students, I know that moles are not affected by temperature. So, I can say that moles would be constant. Okay. So, ma'am is saying that this is some constant K value. Yeah. Yeah. Molarity would be the inversely proportional to volume, because moles would be constant. So, we can say that molarity here would be inversely proportional to volume. The more you increase the volume, the less would be your molarity, right? Yes. And I know that the temperature, as temperature increases, volume decreases. The question says that the increase in temperature, if you are increasing temperature, your volume is decreasing. Your volume is decreasing, my dear students. If your volume is decreasing, then your molarity will increased. Why? Because denominator is decreased, right? Yes. So ma'am, we can say that increase in temperature decreases the volume and eventually it increases the molarity. It increases the molarity. So molarity to increase, option A would be your correct answer. Now let us see why C and D are not the correct option. Mole fraction to increase. My dear students, if you talk about mole fraction, let us say mole fraction, it is moles of some x upon total moles. Moles, what is moles? Given mass divided by molar mass. Everything is about mass. And since mass is not affected by the change in temperature, so ma'am, this is not affected by temperature. Not affected by temperature. So there will be no effect. There would be no effect on the mole fraction. Fourth point. Fourth is mass percent. My dear students, what is mass percent? Mass of solute divided by mass of solution. Since all the terms that are being discussed in this concentration term is about masses, which is not affected by temperature, so ma'am, option 4 would also not be correct. Right? Yes. So this is also not correct. Only one answer is correct, which is option A. So you got your answer very right. Perfect. Very good. Let's move forward. Let's do the next question. Okay, I'll just drink water. Till then you can write it. Okay, perfect. Okay, I hope you've written it. Right, now let's move forward. The next question is on your screens. What does this question say? This question says that a molar solution is one that contains one mole of a solute in. It is saying you have a molar solution. A molar solution, molar solution, M-O-L-A-R. That is capital M. And what does this say? Moles of solute present per liter of solution. Right? So what does this say? A molar solution is one that contains one mole of solute in 1 liter of solution. In 1 liter of solution. 1 liter of grams? No, this is wrong. 1 liter of solvent? No. 1 liter of solution? Yes. So option C is your correct answer. It is 1 liter of solution, not 1 liter of solvent. Right? Yes. So ma'am, option C would be a correct answer. Very good. Perfect. Let's move forward. Let's move forward. The next question is on your screens. Now you have to solve this question. Pause the video and try the question yourself. Okay? Yes. What does this question say? This question says that the molarity of 20% mass by mass solution of sulfuric acid is 2.55 molar. The density of the solution is. My dear students, you are supposed to find out the density of the solution. Okay? So first of all, just write it down what all information you are given. Okay, the first thing that I am given is the molarity of 20% mass by mass. So 20% mass by mass. What does this mean? How do we interpret it? We interpret as 20 grams of some solution is present in 100 grams of solution. Clear? No issues. So, the molarity of 20% solution of sulfuric acid. My dear students, it is sulfuric acid. So, the solute is H2SO4. Okay. 100 grams of solution. And the molarity of the solution is 2.55 molar. What does 2.55 molar say? This means that you have 2.55 moles of H2SO4. Present in 1 liter solution, right? This is 1 liter solution, or I can say 1000 milliliter solution, right? Yes. Now, 2.55 5 moles. You have 2.55 moles. So can you find the mass of 2.55 moles of H2SO4? Yes, ma'am. So mass of H2SO4 would be number of moles, which is 2.55 into 98. The molar mass of H2SO4 is 98 grams per mole. Okay. So now you are supposed to multiply 2.55 by 98. Just solve it. Let's see what does this give you. Calculator, 2.55 into 98 is 249.9. So let us say 249.9, or we can say approximately 250 grams. Approximately 250 grams. So 250 grams of H2SO4 is present in 1000 milliliter of solution, and here 20 grams is present in 100 grams of solution. Okay. If 250 grams is present in 1000 milliliter solution, so can you find out that how much mass of this solution is present, right? Yes, let's see this bacha. If 20 grams H2SO4 is present in 100 grams of solution, so 1 gram of H2SO4 would be present in 100 upon 20 grams of solution. Yes, clear? Yes. And we have 250 grams of the H2SO4. So 250 grams of H2SO4 would be present in 100 upon 20 into 250 grams of solution, right? So let's just solve it. This would be 5, 5, 5, 25, 5, 2, 5, 2, 10, 11, 12, 1, 2, 5, 0 grams solution. Okay. Yes. Now you know that 250 grams is present in 1000 milliliter solution, and that 250 gram is also present in 1250 grams of solution. So you can say that density of the solution would be mass of solution divided by volume of solution. This would be in grams, this would be in milliliters. Mass of solution by volume of solution. So what is the mass of solution? 1250 divided by volume of the solution is 1000 milliliters. So 1000, this would give you 1.25 grams per milliliter. So this is how you are going to calculate the density. This is how you are going to calculate the density of the solution. Let's just revise it what we did. We were given that 20% mass by my solution. So I just find out that 20 grams of H2SO4 is present in 100 grams of solution. I was given the molarity of the solution. I just wrote it down. 2.55 moles of H2SO4 is present in 1 liter solution, or it is present in 1000 milliliters of solution. 2.55 moles, how much does that weigh? 2.55 grams moles means you have nearly 250 grams of your solution. That means you have nearly 250 grams of your solution, right? Yes. So I know that 250 grams of the solution is present in 1000 milliliter. I know that the same solutions, 250 gram is present in 1000 milliliter of solution. If I can find out the mass of that solution, I can find out everything. Yes. So I just saw that since 20 grams of H2SO4 is present in 100 grams, so if I find out that 250 grams of H2SO4 would be present in how much grams of solution, then I'll have the mass of that 1000 ml solution. So I just calculated by unitary method that since 20 is present in 100 grams, 1 would be present in 100 upon 20, and 250 grams would be present in 1250 grams of the solution. Now I have the mass of 1000 ml of solution, which is 1250 grams. So we can find out the density, that is mass by volume, which will give me 1.25 ml, right? Yes. So I hope you got this. This was a very good question, right? So you can write this question and just let me know in the comment section that were you able to solve this question or not. So you can just pause the video and write this question. So let's start again. I hope you've written this. Okay, now let's move forward to the next question. The question is here, just read the question and solve yourself. First, you have to pause the video and do the question yourself. Okay, The question says, calculate the quantity of sodium carbonate. You are supposed to calculate the quantity of sodium carbonate. What is sodium carbonate, ma'am? Bacha, NaCO3. Okay, yes. This is plus 1, this is minus 2. So, this would be 1, 2, cross multiply Na2CO3. So, you're going to write it like this. Okay, perfect. The calculate the quantity of sodium carbonate required to prepare 250 ml of 0.1 molar solution. Okay, ma'am. So, sodium carbonate we are given and we are supposed to calculate the mass. Calculate the quantity of sodium carbonate required to prepare 250 ml of 0.1 molar solution. If you have 0.1 molar solution, can you calculate the moles of your solute? Yes, ma'am, we can calculate. We know that molarity is equal to moles of solute divided by volume of solution in liters. Right? Yes. What is the molarity given here? We are given 0.1 molar. So, ma'am, 0.1 molar molarity we are given. We are supposed to calculate the moles of solute. So, we are going to calculate the moles of solute divided by the volume is given as 250 ml. What it is given? 250 ml. My dear students, it is in ml. And we have to calculate it in liters. So, we have to divide it by 1000. So, ma'am, divided by 1000. 1.4. So, moles of solute would be 0.1 into 1 by 4. 0.1 into 1 by 4. Right? Yes. This is the moles of solute. What is your solute? Na2CO3. Sodium carbonate. And you are supposed to find out its mass. Right? So, you can say that moles of Na2CO3 is 0.1 by 4. So, what will be the mass of Na2CO3? Mass of Na2CO3 would be 0.1 by 4 into, let's calculate the molar mass of Na2CO3. 23 into 23, which would be 46 plus 12 plus 16, 4. So, this would be 48, right? 10 and 6, this would be 16. 6 and 1, 4, 5, 6 and 10. 106 grams. 106 grams? Yes. So, this would be into 106, right? So, this would be 10.6 by 4, 5.3 by 2 or 2.6. Approximately 2.6 grams, right? Please check the calculations. Again, I am telling you, disclaimer, my dear students, just check the calculation. The steps are absolutely right. I take guarantee of that. Perfect. So, this is how you're going to solve this question, right? Just find the moles of solute and then find the molar mass and then just multiply the moles into the molar mass and you will get the mass of your solute. Perfect. So, you just need to interpret the questions and you can solve all the questions yourself. Perfect. So, this is only just the trailer, my dear students. You have to practice a lot of questions, okay? Only then you can gain confidence in this particular chapter. Perfect. Let's move forward. Okay, now we are going to discuss about the next topic, which is vapor pressure. What is vapor pressure? Let's discuss about that. Whenever you talk about vapor pressure, what are you supposed to imagine? Okay, I am going to teach you this with a very interesting story. Okay, so you have to just think of yourself into a jail. Okay, so think about yourself. You are in a jail. Okay, so this is the jail. I might have the picture as well. Yeah, I'll take this. Okay, so this is the jail. Perfect. Now, in a jail, there are a lot of prisoners. Yes, ma'am. Some of the prisoners are here on the surface. What is the surface? This is the gate. These are the gates of the jail, right? From where you can see the people outside. Okay. And some of the prisoners are inside just chilling. So, I just made like this. Okay. Clear? No issues. Now, my dear students, what you have to imagine here is the most important thing. Now, imagine that this particular prisoner is inside. though he has not seen the outside world for so long right now. Yes, ma'am. He's not seen the world outside. So he's very happy. He does not have any problem. He just sees all the nearby prisoners and he feels like this is what everyone's life is. Okay. So he doesn't have any temptations to go outside. Right? Yes. So he can see this side. 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 This side. This side. Every side is same to him. Right? Yes. So this particular prisoner is stable. This particular prisoner is stable. He's not at all unstable. He does not want anything from life. He's very happy where he is. Okay. Now, imagine a prisoner sitting here. Let's talk about this particular prisoner. He can see the outside world. He's seeing the outside world. People are playing. People are working. People are happy. People are free. Right? This particular prisoner now wants to go out. He wants to go out because he's seen the outside world, right? Yes. Whenever he sees this side, he feels fine. The other prisoners are exactly like me. Whenever he sees this side, he feels like fine. The prisoners are like me. Whenever he sees this side, he feels that fine. Prisoners are like me only and life is normal. But once he sees upside, he just wants to go outside. So yes, this particular prisoner is not stable. He is unbalanced. He wants the outside world, right? So I can say that he has some temptations of going outside. He is unstable. He is not stable. He is not balanced. He is unbalanced. Yes. Now you have to imagine this with the chemistry terms. Okay. There is a molecule in the bulk. A molecule in the bulk of the solution will experience equal forces from all the directions, right? So he is stable. He does not have any energy. He is balanced. He is balanced. Okay. But a molecule on the surface of the liquid, a molecule on the surface of the liquid is unbalanced. He can experience force from inside the bulk, from the sides, but on the surface, there's no one to apply force on it, right? So he is unbalanced. And since he is unbalanced, he is high in energy. This molecule has high energy, but this particular molecule does not have energies. Similarly, all these molecules have unbalanced forces. Unbalanced forces means they have energy. They have the temptation to go outside, right? Yes. Now, you know that there are many policemen, right? Which always guard the prisoners. Yes, ma'am. Now, once or someday there is a point that that a prisoner gets a chance to just fly away from the jail, right? That is what happened. This particular prisoner just got a chance to run away. So he just ran away, right? Yes. So he just ran this side. Now he is free. Now he is very happy. Now he is very happy. So what will he do? He will run around. He would roam around like anything, right? Yes, he would go this side. He would go here. He would go here. He would go here. He would go here, 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 here. And because of so much of excitement, One day, whenever a prisoner flies away, what does happen? All the soldiers are asked to go and catch him, right? Yes, so all the soldiers are looking for him and he's roaming around like anything. So what will happen? One time or the other, those soldiers will catch him, yes, and they'll bring him back. And when they'll bring him back, when they are on the run to search for him, the other molecules have chances, the other prisoners have chances to go out. Yes. So what happens that then this molecule, I'll just give it some other color. This molecule starts running like anything. Okay. So this is how the molecules leave their surfaces. This is how the molecules leave their surfaces. Now let us study this in chemistry terms. Here, the prisoner ran away. That is, the molecule on the surface were unbalanced. They had high energy. So they just left the surface. The moment they left the surface, they turned into vapor. What does they turn into? They turned into vapor. That is in the upper area. Now, they have been turned into vapor, right? What happened? Where I said the soldiers caught the first prisoner who ran away. The same way, my dear students, the molecules which go into the vapor state also come back to the liquid state as well. That is, there is an equilibrium maintained between the particles. It is not that if the molecules have been in the vapor state, they will not come back to the liquid state. They can come back to the liquid state. And this is how slowly and slowly molecules start going into the vapor phase. And once they are in the vapor phase, some molecules come back to the liquid state, some molecules go back to the vapor state. And this is how eventually equilibrium is maintained, where equal number of molecules start going to the vapor phase and equal number of molecules start coming to the liquid phase. And this is how an equilibrium is maintained. And when this equilibrium comes, that particular state is known as the vapor pressure of a particular solution or a particular solvent. Since here we are talking about only one solvent, so what you can say that, what is vapor pressure? Vapor pressure is the saturated state or the equilibrium state where equal number of molecules are in the vapor state and equal number of molecules are coming back to the liquid state as well. Right? Yes. So, saturated vapor. What is saturated vapor? The vapor where equilibrium has been maintained, equal number of molecules are going up and down, right? So saturated vapor is at equilibrium where vapor is in equilibrium with the liquid state. Okay? Yes. So, this is how vapor pressure develops. Now, when the molecules strike the surface, they exert some pressure. And at this equilibrium state, the pressure exerted by the vapors is known as the vapor pressure. So, I can say that what is vapor pressure? Pressure exerted by the vapors at the saturated state is known as vapor pressure of a solvent. Okay, I hope you got this. Yes, ma'am. Perfect. Now, let's move forward. So, you got the point that how vapor pressure develops and when do you call it vapor pressure? Vapor pressure of a solvent is only called when it is in its saturated state, when there is an equilibrium maintained between the vapor phase and the liquid phase. Okay, at that moment, the pressure exerted by the vapor is known as the vapor pressure. Perfect. Very good. Now, let's move forward. Now, my dear students, initially what was happening? Ma'am, initially vaporization was taking place, right? But the condensation has not started. What is condensation? When your vapor phase gets converted into the liquid phase, right? Yes. So, what can I say? Ma'am, slowly and slowly when condensation starts, ma'am, condensation slowly and slowly keeps on increasing. Condensation, ma'am, slowly and slowly keeps on increasing and at equilibrium, it is constant. Similarly, the vaporization process, this is condensation. Similarly, the vaporization process slowly and slowly decreases, right? Yes, ma'am, the vaporization process slowly and slowly decreases when your condensation starts increasing and they both come to an equilibrium state, which is this. This is your equilibrium state, right? Yes, so this is your vaporization. And the pressure exerted at this moment is known as your vapor pressure. So I hope you got the idea what is vapor pressure, what is condensation. Initially, your vaporization would be maximum. All the molecules would be running into the vapor phase. Yes, ma'am. But once the condensation starts, slowly and slowly condensation will increase and this will come down and they both will attain an equilibrium and the pressure exerted at this particular moment is known as your vapor pressure. Clear? Perfect. Very good. Now let's move forward. Now let's talk some concepts which we have already discussed, right? Vapor pressure is the maximum pressure. My dear students, vapor pressure is the maximum pressure exerted by a vapor in equilibrium with the liquid. Equilibrium state is very important, okay? So vapor pressure is the maximum pressure exerted by a vapor in the equilibrium with the liquid. Vapor pressure represents the pressure of the saturated vapor. It represents the pressure of the saturated vapor where no more vapors can be formed. There is an equilibrium maintained now, no more vapors will be formed. Right? Yes. So, vapor pressure represents the pressure of the saturated vapor. Next, vapor pressure depends only on temperature. My dear students, vapor pressure only and only depends on temperature. If you increase the temperature, obviously you know that molecules will have a lot of energy and more number of particles would go into the vapor phase. So, as we increase the temperature, vapor pressure would increase. This you can also understand, my dear students. What will happen if you increase the temperature, the molecules will have more energy and the molecules which are on surface, they'll have more energy, they'll move forward more fast, right? Yes. So, the vapor pressure depends only on temperature and the nature of the liquid. Obviously, if a liquid is more volatile, then its molecules would have more energy and they'll go more forward, right? I'll give you the example of volatile and non-volatile as well, but you can right now understand that vapor pressure depends on two major factors. One is the temperature and the other is the nature of the liquid. Different liquids will have different vapor pressures. That is so normal, right? Yes. And also vapor pressure depends on temperature. If you have more temperature, the vapor pressure would be more, right? Yes. Perfect. Vapor pressure does not depend on the volume of the container or the amount of the liquid. It does not depend on the volume of the container. Vapor pressure would be same. If you have the vapor, if vapor pressure is there, then the whatever the volume would be, what that doesn't matter. There will be an equilibrium maintained and your vapor pressure would be the same. So it does not depend on volume of the container or the amount of the liquid, right? It is a surface phenomena. The more the surface area, the more would be the vapor pressure. Clear? Very good. You can write these. You can pause the video and write these. I'll just drink water and then we'll move forward. Okay. Let's start. Okay. Now, we are going to calculate the vapor pressure of the solution. Till now, when you were talking about the vapor pressure, you were talking about only one particular solvent. If you have one solvent, you will calculate its vapor pressure and everything is very normal. What if you have a solution? What if you have a solution? Okay, now we are going to talk about that. And first of all, let me give you the difference between volatile and non-volatile. What are volatile components? The components which can exert pressure are known as volatile. For example, water. If you heat water, its molecules would go into the vapor phase and you will get a vapor pressure. If I talk about some other solution, let us say acetone. Acetone will also have some vapor pressure. But now, if I give you some solution such as let's say I am giving you a solution such as not solution I'll give you a component which would be the best way to make you understand. Imagine I give you this phone. Okay, yes, this is in solid state. Yes, ma'am. If you heat it, will the vapors come out? No, ma'am. राइट, इफ इट इज कम्प्लीटली सॉलिड एंड इट डज नॉट हैव एनी वेपर्स, एनी पार्टिकल्स कमिंग आउट, देन वॉट विल हैपन, इट डज नॉट एक्सर्ट एनी वेपर प्रेशर, सो इट वुड बी नॉन वोलेटाइल. सो वॉट आर नॉन वोलेटाइल? द कॉम्पोनेंट्स विच डू नॉट एक्सर्ट वेपर प्रेशर, विच डू नॉट हैव वेपर प्रेशर, दे आर नोन एज योर नॉन वोलेटाइल components. Okay, non-volatile components are the components which do not exert any pressure, whereas if you talk about volatile components, they exert pressure. The more they exert pressure, the more they are volatile, right? Yes, so you can write the difference. Components which exert pressure, components which have vapor pressure, okay, and what are non-volatile? Components which do not have vapor pressure. You heat them how much you want, but they'll not exert any pressure. Okay, so this is the basic difference between volatile and non-volatile. Now let us talk about a solution where you have a solvent and a solute. So it is a binary solution and both the components are volatile. Now both the components are volatile. Now if they are volatile, so they exert some vapor pressure. Okay, perfect. Now imagine you have one solution, you have one solvent A, pure A. You have pure A which is volatile. You have pure A which is volatile. You added first of all, don't add anything. If I ask you what would be the vapor pressure of this component of pure liquid A, it is volatile. You will say, ma'am, let P A naught is the vapor pressure of A. Vapor pressure of pure A. Okay, no issues. Now, let me tell you that you added some pure B into this particular solution. So, pure B is also volatile, this is also volatile. So, if this is volatile, then you can say that, ma'am, PB naught would be the vapor pressure. Pure B, this would be the vapor pressure of pure B. Yes, ma'am. Now, once they both are mixed together, you will get a solution. Now you have A plus B and both are volatile. Right? Now, it will have some P pressure. So, you will say P is the pressure, vapor, I'll write Vp, okay? Vp, that is vapor pressure of solution. Okay, now my question to you is, let us say that mole fraction of A in this solution is xA and mole fraction of B in this solution is xB. Right? Yes. You have two solutions, you have two components now in this solution. The mole fraction of A is xA and the mole fraction of B is xB. I know that the component which is more volatile, who will be more volatile? Which gets converted into the vapor state more easily, that is more volatile. Yes, ma'am, you said that volatile are those which exert vapor pressure and the more volatile would be which exerts more vapor pressure. Right? Yes. Now, my dear students, if I ask you that the vapor pressure exerted, this P total pressure would be equal to PA plus PB, the pressure exerted by A as well as B, because both are volatile, so both will exert some pressure, right? Here, PA and PB are the vapor pressures, partial vapor pressures of A and B respectively, Why, ma'am, partial vapor pressure? My dear students, initially when you had only one component, that was exerting some PA naught pressure. Now, once some other solution is coming into the mixture, some other solution will come into the mixture, it will cause some hindrance, right? You will not get pure vapor pressure which you were getting initially. Yes, so P and PB would be the pressures exerted by them in the solution. Individually, they will exert PA naught and PB naught, but once they are in the solution, they will exert some PA pressure, and this PA pressure would be less than PA naught. You get this point? Yes. Similarly, PB would be less than PB naught. You get this point, my dear students? Yes, ma'am. Perfect. So you got this idea, and this PA plus PB would give you the total pressure of your solution. Now, the more the amount of A, the more pressure it will exert. You get this point? That is, if I say that PA would be directly proportional to the mole fraction of A, the more the moles of A are present in the solution, the more would be the pressure, right? Why? If you have this solution and your, let us say, A components are with blue color, so the more the blue particles are on the surface, the more they will exert the pressure. The less, let us say this is green is B. So if you have B per moles less, if you have mole fraction of B less, then its molecules on the surface would also be less, and it will also exert pressure less. Yes, so we can say that the pressure exerted by a poor component would be directly proportional to the mole fraction of that component in that particular solution. So we can say that PA is directly proportional to XA. PB is directly proportional to mole fraction of B. When you remove this proportionality constant, you get PA is equal to PA naught XA. How are you getting this? Now, first I'll just tell you, PA is equal to some K constant into XA. Okay? Yes. What is XA? It is the mole fraction of A present in that solution. What is XA? Mole fraction of A in solution. Imagine when your mole fraction XA is equal to 1, what will happen? Ma'am, mole fraction of XA means 1. It means that the whole of the solution is A. There is no B present, right? Only then you will get the value as 1. Na? The sum of all the components mole fraction give you 1. So ma'am, if XA is 1, this means that it is a pure solvent of A. Right? It is a pure solvent of A. So, ma'am, we can say that PA would become PA naught, and K would be this and this into 1. So, ma'am, K value would be PA naught. So, what can we say? Put this in 1. Put in 1. What will you get? PA is equal to PA naught XA. Similarly, you can say for B, PB is equal to PB naught XB. Right? Yes. Now put these both in this. So what can we say? We can say that P total would be equal to PA plus PB. P total would be equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught XB. Right? Yes. So this is one expression which is very important for you. Let's study further. I know that it is a solution with two components. I know that this is a solution with two components. If it is a solution with two components, then I can say that mole fraction of A plus mole fraction of B should be equal to 1. Right? So I can say that XB would be equal to 1 minus XA. Use this here. So P total would be equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught into 1 minus XA. Right? Yes. This would be PA naught XA plus PB naught minus PB naught XA. So PA naught minus PB naught into XA plus PB naught. This is some other expression if you are given a binary solution. If you are given binary solution and you are given the mole fraction of only one component, let us say A. So you can use this expression and calculate the total pressure. Clear? Yes. Very good. So this is how you are going to calculate the pressures when you have both the components volatile. Right? Yes. Very good. Very good. P total is equal to PA naught minus PB naught XA plus PB naught. Clear? Yes. Raoult's law of vapor pressure. This is what is known as Raoult's law of vapor pressure. Partial pressure of any component, if you are talking about partial pressure, means PA or PB. Okay, so partial pressure of any component is proportional to the mole fraction of that component. As we talked about, PA is directly proportional to XA and PB was directly proportional to XB. This was given by the Raoult's law. Okay, in the liquid solution, and we just calculated that PA is equal to PA naught XA and PB is equal to PB naught XB. Clear? Yes. This is what is given by the Raoult's law. Raoult's law said that the component which has mole fraction, more mole fraction in the solution will exert more vapor pressure, and that is what is written here. Clear? Perfect. Very good. Let's move forward. Now you have a question. We'll talk about the question. First, let's discuss what we have studied till now. P total is equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught XB. I can write this as PA naught. I know that mole fraction of A can be written as moles of A upon moles of A plus moles of B. This will be equal to PB naught into moles of B upon moles of A plus moles of B. Right? Yes. Now, what can you say? You can say that PA naught into moles of A plus PB naught into moles of B divided by moles of A plus moles of B. This expression is also very important. If you are not given the mole fraction, but you are given the moles of both the components, then you can calculate the total pressure as like this. P total would be equal to PA naught moles of A upon plus PB naught moles of B upon moles of A plus moles of B. Right? So this expression is also very important. So you can just mark it like this. Clear? Yes. Very good. Now let's move forward. I know that some more expressions, my dear students. PA is equal to PA naught XA or PA naught moles of A upon moles total. Right? I know that PB is equal to PB naught XB or PB naught moles of B upon moles total. Right? So this is first and this is your second equation. Divide 1 by 2. Now when you divide 1 by 2, you will get that PA by PB would be equal to PA naught moles of A upon PB naught moles of B. So this is another important expression for you. So PA is equal to PA naught moles fraction of A moles of A, PB naught moles of B. Right? You can calculate the ratio as like this. Clear? No issues? Perfect. Now we are going to talk about the most important thing. The most important thing is that from Raoult's law, the law which we were studying like right now, from Raoult's law, we discussed that PA is equal to PA naught XA. Right? Yes. And PB is equal to PB naught XB. This is for solutions. Right? Yes, Raoult's law is for solutions, liquid solutions. Now, if you talk about Dalton's law, which you studied in the states of matter chapter, then we would talk about Dalton's law. Dalton's law, what did it talk about? It talked about the vapor pressure, the partial vapor pressure exerted in the vapor phase. It was for the vapor phase. So you will write for vapor phase. What was the expression? Partial pressure of a gas, which is PA, is equal to total pressure exerted into Y of A. PB would be equal to P total into Y of B. Now the question is, ma'am, what is YA and YB? So here you have to revise the whole concept. YA is the mole fraction in vapor phase. In vapor phase, YA and YB. Okay. And if you talk about XA and XB, then these were the mole fraction of the components in the liquid phase. That is mole fraction in liquid phase. If you still didn't get it, wait, I'll tell you again. You had this solution. You had this. This was your solution. And this was the vapor state. Right? Yes. What did you say? You said that the liquid solution was going into the vapor phase. The upper phase? Yes. The mole fraction of the components in this liquid would be XA and XB. The components which just went into the vapor phase, mole fraction would become YA and YB. So the same components, mole fraction in the liquid solution is given by XA and XB, and the same components, mole fraction in the vapor phase would be given by YA and YB. It would be given by YA and YB. Clear? Yes. So this is how you are going to differentiate between the two. Perfect. Now, why did ma'am just told us this? Because my dear students, this PA and this PA both are equal because both are the partial vapor pressures of the components. So since these both are equal, so we can say that equating, PA naught XA is equal to P total into Y of A. So PA naught upon P total will be equal to YA upon XA. Right? Yes. So these expressions are important because you are going to calculate them. Right? Yes. So this is how you are going to discuss this. Perfect. Okay. Clear? More expressions, my dear students. More expressions. What are the expressions? You know this Dalton's law. You know this Dalton's law. Yes, ma'am. So what are you going to do? Divide the two. Okay. So let us say this is 6 and this is 7. So divide the two. Okay. 6 divided by 7. What will we get? PA is equal to P total into YA. PA is equal to P total into Y of A divided by PB is equal to P total into Y of B. So if PA is equal divided by PB will be equal to P total cancel, Y of A upon Y of B. What is Y of A? It is the mole fraction of A component in the vapor phase. It is the mole fraction. Na? This will be equal to moles of A upon moles total in the vapor phase. Divided by moles of B upon total moles in the vapor phase. Right? Yes, ma'am. So, cut total. You will get PA by PB will also give you moles of A by moles of B. But these moles will be in the moles in vapor phase. So, this is all that we can study from Rawls' law. There are hundreds of things which you can interpret from the Dalton's law and the Rawls' law. Okay, my dear students. So, I hope you got this. If you've not got this, then you have to revise it, my dear students, because all the expressions are very, very important. The expressions which I have put into the square or I have marked hashtag, all the expressions are very important for your numerical point of view. Now we are going to apply this concept in the questions or numericals. So here is the question. The vapor pressure of pure liquid A and B are 450 and 700 mm of Hg. So whatever information is given, just note it down. Okay. So now let us note it down. I am given that PA naught is equal to 450. Okay. And PB naught is given as 700. Perfect. At 350 Kelvin. Okay, perfect. Find out the composition of liquid mixture. Now you have to find out the composition of liquid mixture. My dear students, composition in the liquid mixture means they are asking you to calculate XA and XB. Okay, not YA and YB, because YA and YB will be in the vapor phase. This is in the liquid phase. If total vapor pressure is 600 mm, if you are given that P total is equal to 600 mm. Hg, right? Yes. So from Raoult's law, because Raoult's law is applicable to liquid solutions. Okay. From Raoult's law, I know that P total is equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught XB. Okay. The vapor pressure of pure liquid A and B are this and this respectively. Find out the composition of the liquid mixture if total pressure is given. Right. Now, I know this. Now, I have two components which I don't know. How am I going to calculate it? I know that XA plus XB is equal to 1. So, XA will be equal to 1 minus XB. So, put this in this. Okay. So, you will get P total is equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught 1 minus XA. This would be PA naught XA plus PB naught minus PB naught XA. Okay. So P total will be equal to PA naught minus PB naught into XA plus PB naught. Now you can calculate XA and then you can calculate XB. You have P total given as how much? 600. And PA is given as 450 and PB is given as 700. So just reciprocate it. Okay. So I'll just reciprocate it. I'll write it like this only. Okay. This is 450 minus 700 into XA plus PB is 700. Okay. PB is 700. Perfect. You have to solve this, my dear students. You will calculate XA. You can find XA. Once you find XA, just subtract that XA from 1. You will get XB. Yes. So calculate that as well. Perfect. Very good. You will get XA and XB. Next is also find the composition in the vapor phase. Now you are supposed to find the composition in the vapor phase. How are you going to calculate the composition in the vapor phase? Let's see. The expressions which I taught you were these. PA by PB, it gives you mole fraction of A by mole fraction of B, right? You know that whenever you calculate this, you can calculate PA and PB, my dear students, if you are given. You know that PA by PB, we know PA by PB is equal to Y of A by Y of B, right? I told you this. You're supposed to find out Y and YB. Yes. You know PA by PB are the partial pressures. You also know that PA is equal to PA naught XA and PB is equal to PB naught XB. Right. Perfect. No issues. Yes, ma'am. PA is equal to PA naught XA. PB is equal to PB naught XB. You just calculated XA and XB from here. Right. Should I calculate? I'll calculate for you. 600 is equal to 450, 0, 10, 5 and 6 minus 4, 250. Okay. XA plus 700 and this would be minus. तो दिस वुड बी 600 इज इक्वल टू 700 माइनस 250 वुड गिव मी 450 450 नो दिस वुड बी हेयर इट विल कम 250 एंड दैट वुड बी 100 ओके दिस वुड बी 600 प्लस 250 एक्स से 700 माइनस 600 दिस वुड बी 250 एक्स ए एंड दिस वुड बी 100 तो एक्स ए वुड बी 100 अपॉन 250 विच इज 2 by 5 सो एक्स ए इज 2 by 5 तो एक्स बी वुड बी 3 by 5 1 माइनस 2 by 5 विच इज 3 by 5 राइट यस नाउ यूज दिस माई डियर स्टूडेंट्स यू नो दैट पी ए बाई पी बी पी ए बाई पी बी कैन बी कैलकुलेटेड यू नो पी ए नॉट इज गिवन एज 450 सो 450 इंटू 2 by 5 and this would be 700 into 3 by 5 right yes you can calculate pa and pb yes and you know that pa by pb will give you ya and yb so just calculate ya and yb right this is how you are going to calculate all the factors so you need to understand what are they asking you and you need to know the expressions I am not telling you to learn them to mug up them don't do that just understand how are they derived okay yes I hope you got this question this was a very important question okay now we'll move forward okay now we are going to talk about the solutions if you have one particular solution as a non-volatile solute. Initially, we had two components and both the components were volatile. What if one of the component is non-volatile? One of the component does not form vapor. What will happen? Okay, now we will discuss about that. Non-volatile solute is PB naught would be zero. You know that non-volatile solute will not have any vapor pressure. Since it will not have any vapor pressure, so PB naught would be equal to zero. Okay, now if you have some A component, pure A, then its vapor pressure would be PA naught, right? Yes, so ma'am, vapor pressure of pure A. Clear? No issues? Perfect. Now, you added some B component which is non-volatile. Right? Yes. So, I can say that P total would be equal to PA plus PB. The way we did initially. I know that PA will be equal to PA naught XA and PB would be equal to PB naught XB. Now, since my dear students, B is non-volatile, its PB naught would be equal to 0. Yes, ma'am. So, this full value would be equal to 0. What can I say? I can say that P total would be equal to PA XA. Right? Yes. So, this would be the total pressure. Now, my question to you is, out of PT and PA naught, which will be more? Which vapor pressure is more? The vapor pressure of the pure A or the vapor pressure of the solution? If you see, then you can say that, ma'am, initially, ma'am, the whole of the surface was available to A for going into the vapor phase. Yes. When you added a non-volatile solute, that is B. When you added some non-volatile solute B, it itself didn't form any vapor. But ma'am, it actually hindered the A molecules to go into the vapor phase as well. So, the vapor pressure of the solution will always be less than the pure solvent. So, P total will always be less than PA naught. This is very important thing to realize. Okay, yes. So, when a non-volatile solute is added, the vapor pressure of the solution is decreased. It is decreased because it causes hindrance for the volatile component to go into the vapor phase. Right? Yes. So, write this and then we will move forward. Okay, you might have written this. Now let's move forward. What are we going to discuss? Okay, colligative properties. Before starting the colligative properties, we would discuss something very important first, my dear students, which is your ideal solutions. Okay, what are ideal solutions? Let us discuss first about ideal solutions and then we will start colligative properties. Okay, yes. What are ideal solutions? We just studied, what we studied? We studied, ma'am, Raoult's law, yes. And Raoult's law was when you have some mixture of two volatile solutions, then the vapor pressure exerted by them is directly proportional to the mole fraction of that component, right? Yes. Now, the solutions which follow Raoult's law at all concentrations are regarded as ideal solutions. Yes. So, what can we say that a solution that obeys the Raoult's law at any composition is known as ideal solution. But it is again an ideal thing which is never followed, right? Yes. Now, no real solution is ideal. No real solution is ideal, my dear students. A real solution at very high dilution can behave ideally. But yes, a very, very dilute solution can behave ideally. But there is no solution which at all concentrations will follow Raoult's law in present life. Okay, ideal solution is just a hypothetical concept. Okay, just like the ideal gas equation. Perfect. Now, let's move forward. Now, for ideal solution, there should be some thermodynamic conditions as well. Yes. So, what are ideal solutions and what are their thermodynamic conditions? They are very important. So, now we are going to discuss about them. The first condition is that its delta H mixing, that is its enthalpy should be equal to zero. What does this mean? That is enthalpy before the two solvents were in pure state and the enthalpy after they were mixed should be zero. When will this be possible? This will be only possible when, let us say, I have AA and BB components. Okay, yes, this is pure A, this is pure B, and I just mixed them and I got AB. Okay, yes, perfect. Now, my dear students, if the initial interaction, that is AA interaction and BB interaction, is exactly equal to the AB interaction, only then delta H mixing will be 0. Only then delta H mixing would be 0, otherwise the delta H will have some positive or negative value. So, when delta H mixing is 0, we know that when a bond is broken, you are giving some amount of energy, right? Yes. So, when you are breaking some bond, you are giving some amount of energy, that is energy is absorbed, that is delta H should be positive. Whenever a bond is formed, energy is released, that is delta H is negative. But my dear students, if we want delta H mixing to be 0, this means that, ma'am, AA interactions should be equal to BB interactions and these interactions should be equal to AB interactions. Only then delta H mixing would be 0. So, the energy absorbed when solvent-solvent bonds and the solute-solute bonds are broken, right? Now, these two bonds would be broken, only then a new bond would be formed. So, the amount of energy which was used in breaking these two bonds should be exactly equal to the amount of energy that is required to make the amount of energy required to break this bond should be equal to the energy released when AB bond was formed. Only then delta H mixing would be 0, na? Yes, ma'am. Perfect. So, the energy absorbed when solvent-solvent bonds and solute-solute bonds are broken is exactly equal to the energy released when solute-solvent bond is formed. Perfect. Now, let's move forward to the second point. Second point is that delta V mixing should be equal to 0. That is, the volume before mixing and the total volume after mixing should be 0. Only then delta V mixing would be 0. And this is very easy. This is very simple. Since intermolecular attractions doesn't change, since these interactions are not changing, so if you are adding 1 liter volume with this 1 liter volume, you will get 2 liter volume here. And that is so normal. Right? Yes. Since intermolecular attraction does not change after mixing, volume remains the same. Right? Yes. So, delta H mixing should be 0, delta V mixing should be 0, and my dear students, third is entropy should be positive. What is entropy? Now, let us talk about entropy, my dear students. When you talk about entropy, it is the degree of randomness. Imagine you have only yellow balls in a box. Now, you will put your hand and you will get a yellow ball. Imagine you have only red balls in one hand, you will get only red balls. Once you mix both of them, Once you mix both of them, there is the possibility of randomness. You will put your hand in the box and you might get yellow or you might get red balls, right? Yes. So that is the degree of randomness. So when you have the solvents pure, you don't have any randomness. But once the mixture is made, you have some randomness because now you have two different components. So entropy is always positive in a mixture. So AABB gives you 2AB. Here no randomness, here no randomness, but yes, there is a randomness. So here delta S would be positive, right? In solution, we have two different types of particles and the pure solvent. Ideal mixing is a spontaneous process and it is entropy driven, right? Perfect. Now let's move forward. Next, deviation from Raoult's law. Now, my dear students, I told you that no solution behaves ideally, right? Yes, so they will have some deviation. What type of deviations can they have? They can have two deviations. They can have a positive deviation. And they can have negative deviation. Now, we will discuss about all both the deviations individually. Right? Yes. Perfect. So, first of all, for this, we need to plot a Raoult's law plot. Okay, how are we going to plot it? Imagine you have two volatile solutes which is absolutely ideal. So I am giving you a plot for ideal solution. Okay, you have two components. Let us say I have component A and component B. I have component A and component B. Okay, so this gives you the mole fraction of the components. Perfect. And this particular part gives you the pressure. Okay, and this also gives you the pressure. Now, if I, you know that XA plus XB will always be equal to 1, right? Yes. So I can say that if this is increasing, then this has to decrease. Yes, since their sum is equal, so we can say that if one is increasing, the other has to decrease, right? Yes, so the other decreases. Perfect. Now we will move forward. Imagine X is equal to 1 here. If X is equal to 1, this means that you don't have B. Your B value, mole fraction of B would be 0. Yes, ma'am. Now, my dear students, if whole of your solution is A, then the partial pressure would be PA naught. Yes, ma'am. If XA, imagine this. Now, if this is equal to 0, so you can say, na, P is equal to PA naught XA plus PB naught XB. Here both the components are volatile, my dear students. Here both the components are volatile. Now if XB is equal to 0, then we can say that P is equal to PA naught into 1, and ma'am, total pressure would be PA naught, right? Yes. So this complete pressure, let us say, is PA naught. Okay, my dear students, perfect. Now from here, now when we move forward, the mole fraction of A will keep on decreasing and mole fraction of B will keep on increasing. When we reach here, let us say that B is completely 1 and here it will decrease to 0. So, the total pressure would be PB. Now, imagine, my dear students, it is at the same temperature. Can you tell me out of A and B, which is more volatile? Ma'am, at the same temperature, the component which has a higher vapor pressure will be more volatile because those are volatile who give more vapor pressure. Right? Yes. So, we can conclude from here that, A is more volatile. We can say that A is more volatile. Okay, perfect. Now we are going to plot this. Now join these two. Okay, ma'am, we have joined. So this is the plot that you get from PA and PB not as you increase their mole fractions. This, when we join these two, what we get? P total at any point PA plus PB. Okay, here when you come at this point, P total would be equal to PB naught because you don't have A in it, and when you reach this point, P total would be equal to PA naught when you don't have any B mole fraction in it, right? Yes. So this is the ideal solutions Raoult's law plot. Now we are going to see the deviations. When I said that there could be positive deviation or negative deviation, what do I mean? When I say positive deviation, this means that the total pressure, according to Raoult's law, which we assume that it should be a straight line, if the total pressure is more than this, then that is a positive deviation. And if the pressure comes out to be less than the Raoult's law pressure, then we assume that this is a negative deviation. Right? Yes. Now we will study these one by one. Perfect. First is your positive deviation. If you talk about the positive deviation, then let us call P total as Raoult's law pressure. And let us say P total dash is the pressure of non-ideal solution. Okay. Now, if I am saying that it shows a positive deviation, it means that P total dash should be more than P total. You assume that to be an ideal solution, you calculate the pressure, but if it is showing positive deviation, then the pressure would be more than what you assumed. Okay, this is what is positive deviation. When will positive deviation appear? When can you get more pressure than expected? Ma'am, if you have a solution, see, if one component shows the positive deviation, the other component would show positive deviation. That is normal. Okay, now we are going to study about the thermodynamic terms. If the solute-solvent interaction after mixing, see, you don't read this, you will understand this if I'll explain you. Imagine, you have AA, you have BB interactions, and this is giving you AB interactions. Okay, my dear students, if the interactions after mixing are weak, if the interactions after mixing are weak, then particles have power to go out and show more pressure. Yes, ma'am. So, my dear students, when will you get positive deviation? When after mixing, the interactions are weak. Only then you can see positive deviation. If after mixing interactions are strong, then you will not get the pressure. See, this is right. Now, if all the interactions are equal, you will get Raoult's law. But you are not going to get an ideal solution. You want a positive deviation. This means that you want more pressure than the expected. How can you get more pressure than expected? Only when AB interactions are weaker than AA and BB interactions. Right? So, AB interactions are weaker than AA or BB interactions. This is what gives you a positive deviation. So, if the solute-solvent interactions after mixing decreases, see, if the interactions after mixing decreases, more molecules will move into the vapor phase. They'll go into the vapor phase, contributing the more pressure. Okay, perfect. Next, the energy absorbed to break solvent or solute bond is greater than the energy released when the weaker solvent bond is formed. Okay, so here you are given the examples. Here you are given the examples which show positive deviation. So all these three examples are important because acetone shows hydrogen bonding. Now, once you add hexane into it, the hydrogen bonding will be weak. Similarly, ROH shows hydrogen bonding initially, but once you add cyclohexane, hydrogen bonding will be weak. So after interaction is becoming weaker, and that is the reason it is showing positive deviation. When you have positive deviation, my dear students, when you have positive deviation, what do you say? That your delta H mixing should be positive, your delta V mixing should be positive, and your delta S is always positive. This is always positive. There is no saying to it, but delta H mixing and delta V mixing would be positive. You can understand this as well. Imagine delta V mixing. What is delta V mixing? Initially, the interactions are stronger. Later, after mixing, the interactions are weaker. Now, when interactions are weaker, particles can move more backward, more away from each other. And as the particles can move more away from each other, their volume would increase. So, overall delta V mixing would be positive, right? Yes. So, this is how you are going to remember this positive deviation. You only need to know that all the three thermodynamic terms are positive. First, second, you need to know the reason behind it, that after the interaction, after mixing, the interactions become weaker, and that is the reason you get more vapor pressure than actually expected. Okay, you need to know the examples, you need to know the thermodynamic terms, and my dear students, you need to know the plot. According to the Raoult's law, ideal solution used to give you what? Here was XA 1, XB 0, XA 0, XB 1, PA naught, PB not. You joined it, you got P total, right? Now, if you are talking about, positive deviation, then you will get a plot like this. You will get a plot like this. Okay? You will get pressure more than the expected. So, this is a plot for the positive deviation from Raoult's law, where the pressure would be more than expected. Clear? I hope you understood this. Perfect. Next. Next would be negative deviation. Now, what will happen in negative deviation? If you want to show negative deviation, it means that the pressure of the mixture should be less than the expected Raoult's pressure. And when can it be possible? Only when, ma'am, after mixing, the interactions are stronger. Only when after mixing, the interactions are stronger. Now, if the interactions after mixing are stronger, my dear students, then the particles cannot go in the vapor phase easily. And they will exert less pressure. Right? Yes. So, negative deviation is showed when, if I tell you that, let us say, P total is the pressure of ideal solution and P total dash is the pressure of negative deviation, then what will happen? Ma'am, P total dash would be less than P total always. And when can it be possible? Only when the interactions after are stronger than the initial ones. Okay, perfect. And if we talk about the thermodynamic terms, then my dear students, delta H mixing would be negative, delta V mixing would be negative, but delta S mixing still would be positive. Okay, so now you have to study this. Solvent solute interactions after mixing is stronger. See, after mixing it should be stronger. I told you that. Than solute-solute or solvent-solvent interactions. That is, if you have AA plus BB interactions which are giving you AB interactions, then AB interactions are stronger than AA or BB interactions. Only then the total vapor pressure would be less and you will get negative deviation. Molecules in the liquid state are strongly bound. They are very strongly bound, so they are not able to go to the vapor phase. Few molecules can escape into the vapor phase, contributing less pressure. And here, my dear students, delta H mixing would be negative. Okay, now if we talk about the delta V mixing, then you can understand that first the particles were very easily moving here and there. They had a lot of volume. After mixing, now they are very strong interactions. They are like sitting like this. Then their volume would be less and total delta V mixing would be negative. Okay, so the energy absorbed when solute-solute and solvent-solvent bonds are broken is less than the energy released when solvent-solute bond is formed. So, delta V mixing here would be negative. Clear? Perfect. Molecular attractions increases after mixing. Molecules are drawn closer to each other. As a result, volume decreases. Delta S entropy, my dear students, after mixing, randomness would always be positive value only, because after mixing only there will be more randomness. So, delta S mixing would always be positive, be it positive deviation, be it negative deviation, be it Raoult's law. Okay, yes, so delta S mixing would be positive. Here are few examples which you need to know. In HNO3 and water, initial hydrogen bonding is weaker, but once they both get mixed, they get extensive hydrogen bonding and the interaction becomes stronger. In case of HCl and H2O as well, interaction of hydrogen bonding increases. In case of acetone and CHCl3 also the interaction becomes stronger. Right? Yes. So, these are the examples which you need to learn about the negative deviations. I hope you got the idea. What is an ideal solution? What will happen if the ideal solution, if the solution deviates from ideal behavior, it can have positive deviation or negative deviation. If it has positive deviation, then what are the thermodynamic parameters sign? If it is a negative deviation, what are the thermodynamic parameters sign? What are the plots and also their examples? All these are very important. Perfect. Let's move forward. Now we are supposed to plot the graph. You know that you can plot it. Pause the video and plot yourself. Here you have x a equal to 1, you have x b equal to 0. Here you have x a equal to 0 and x b equal to 1. Here you have p a naught and here you have p b naught. You will join these two, you will join this and you will join this. Right? Yes. This is giving you p total. And now if you see that in a negative deviation, the pressure would be less. Yes, ma'am. So the plot would be something like this. Okay, so this would be the plot for your negative deviation from the Raoult's law. Very good, very good, perfect. Now let's move forward. Now we are going to talk about azeotropes. My dear students, if you got the idea of minimum boiling, if you got the idea of positive deviation and negative deviation, you can very easily understand the part which where is it is azeotropes. Azeotropes are majorly of two types. Minimum boiling azeotrope and maximum boiling azeotrope. Okay. What are azeotropes? The most important thing, you will read a definition in your book as well. What are azeotropes? Azeotropes actually are a mixture of two different solvents, but you cannot separate the two solvents in azeotropes, right? Yes, you have two different solvents, you know that they have different boiling points. So there is a process which is known as steam distillation, which is used for separating the mixtures. If you have a mixture of two different solvents, you can separate them by the process of steam distillation, right? Because they both have different boiling points. You heat them, the one which has lesser boiling point will evaporate fast and it will be condensed, and then you can separate both of them, right? Yes. But in case of azeotropes, if you have one particular type of azeotrope, then you cannot separate the two solutions, be it any way, you cannot separate them. Those are known as the azeotropes. Now, azeotropes are majorly of two types, my dear students. One is minimum boiling azeotrope and maximum boiling azeotrope. Now, you have to understand that how are you going to differentiate this. You know that positive deviation and you know that mixtures of negative deviation. Yes, ma'am. My dear students, imagine what is boiling point. First and the most important thing is, what is boiling point? How do we define boiling point? We say that boiling point is the temperature at which the pressure inside is equal to the atmospheric pressure. Whenever the pressure inside gets equal to the atmospheric pressure, that particular temperature is known as the boiling point of that particular solvent, right? Yes. Now, if a component has higher vapor pressure. If a component has higher vapor pressure, it would vaporize very easily. Yes, ma'am, it would vaporize very easily and it would be equal to the atmospheric pressure at a lower temperature. Right? Yes. So you can say that more the vapor pressure, more the volatile a component is, less will be the boiling point. So can I say that volatility of a component is inversely proportional to the boiling point? If a component is more volatile, it will form more vapors at less temperature and the vapor pressure would be equal to the atmospheric pressure, right? Yes. So, ma'am, we can say its boiling point would be less. Yes. A compound or a component which has more volatility, it will have less boiling point, right? Yes. If a component is less volatile, it will take a lot of temperature to form vapors and it will take a lot of temperature at a higher temperature, its vapor pressure will be equal to the atmospheric pressure, right? Yes. So this is how you call it as boiling point. Okay, ma'am. Yes, we got it, that more the volatile a component is, less would be its boiling point. Now imagine, my dear students, minimum boiling azeotropes. Minimum boiling azeotropes means that they will have minimum boiling point. When can they have minimum boiling point? Ma'am, they can have a minimum boiling point only when they will have very high vapor pressure. And when can they have a very high vapor pressure? When they have a positive deviation. If they have a positive deviation, their vapor pressure is more. I hope you remember the graph. It was something like this. Yes. So, ma'am, if the vapor pressure is more, then boiling point would be less. Vapor pressure more, boiling point would be less. So, ma'am, if I want minimum boiling azeotropes, then which solutions will show minimum boiling azeotropes? The ones which show positive deviation from Raoult's law. So, we got the idea that minimum boiling azeotropes will have low boiling temperatures, low boiling points, and low boiling points means that their vapor pressure should be more, and more vapor pressure is shown by the positive deviation. So, all the mixtures which show positive deviation, they form minimum boiling azeotropes. Similarly, if we talk about the maximum boiling azeotropes, then the maximum boiling azeotropes would be the ones which will form less vapors, and less vapors means the solutions which, the components which show negative deviation from the Raoult's law will show maximum boiling azeotropes. So, negative deviation from Raoult's law. Okay? Yes. So, I hope you got the idea. Who will form minimum boiling azeotropes? Ma'am, whose boiling point should be less, and boiling point less. So, ma'am, we want more vapor pressure. More vapor pressure is shown by the positive deviation from the Raoult's law. Right? Similarly, if we talk about maximum boiling azeotrope, then we want more higher boiling points. When we want higher boiling point, we want less pressure. Less pressure means negative deviation from the Raoult's law. Right? Yes. This is very important and this is very logical. You don't have to mug it up. You only have to just understand the concept. Clear? Very good. Let's move forward. Now, we are going to talk. We'll talk about these questions as well. We'll talk about these questions as well. But first, we will discuss about the topics which we left, which were the colligative properties. Or you want to answer the questions. You will answer the questions, don't worry. First, we will talk about colligative properties now. Okay? Yes. So, let's talk about the colligative properties. Colligative properties are the properties which depend upon the amount of solution. Any solution, any component, it depends on the amount. Only and only amount, not on anything else. It only and only depends on the amount. Those are known as colligative properties. We are going to study majorly four types of colligative properties. Relative lowering of vapor pressure. Next would be elevation in boiling point, depression in freezing point, and then osmotic pressure. Okay, we are going to discuss all these in just few moments. Okay, so now let us start with the lowering of vapor pressure. Imagine the concept I told you, that you have a solution. Now, my dear students, you have a solution, pure A. You added a non-volatile solute B. You added a non-volatile solute B. Okay, now when you added a non-volatile solute B, you know that initially the pressure was PA naught, and ma'am, when we have added some non-volatile solute, obviously the pressure was less, which is PT, and we say that PA naught is more than PT, right? Why? Because the non-volatile solute is causing some hindrance. We also found out that P total will be equal to PA naught XA, right? Yes. Now, If I ask you, my dear students, that what is the lowering of vapor pressure? Lowering of vapor pressure means that, ma'am, the more you will add the non-volatile solute, the more you will add non-volatile solute, the more space it will occupy on the surface. And the more it will occupy on the surface, the more it will cause hindrance, and the lesser would be the vapor pressure. Right? This means that, ma'am, you can say that lowering of vapor pressure is given by delta P, and this delta P is equal to initial pressure PA naught minus PT, and we know that PT is equal to PA naught XA, right? So, we can write that delta P is equal to PA naught minus PA naught XA. Okay, now let's take PA as common. So, ma'am, PA naught is equal to 1 minus XA, right? We know that when we have a solution, then XA plus xb would be equal to 1. So, my dear students, 1 minus xa would be equal to xb. So, what can we say? That delta p is equal to pa naught into xb. Pa naught into xb. This is what is known as lowering of vapor pressure. Right? This is your first expression which is very important, which is lowering of vapor pressure. Now, if I take this Pa naught and cross multiply it, what will I get? I'll get, ma'am, delta P by Pa naught. Delta P by Pa naught. And this would be equal to XB. Right? Yes. And my dear students, this particular part is known as relative lowering. Of vapor pressure. There are two different names which you need to remember. One is lowering of vapor pressure. What is lowering of vapor pressure? Delta P. And that would be equal to Pa naught into XP. If you bring this Pa naught down, then you will say that this is the relative lowering of vapor pressure because you are finding it with some relation. So delta P by Pa naught in whole is known as lowering of vapor pressure. And this will be equal to XB. Right? What is XB? Ma'am, XB is the mole fraction of non-volatile solute. Of non-volatile solute. Okay? So, my dear students, XB is the mole fraction of the non-volatile solute. And PA naught is the vapor pressure of pure A. Okay? So, this is what is known as lowering of vapor pressure. Now, what I want to make you understand is, see, the more the mole fraction of your non-volatile solute, the more the mole fraction of your non-volatile solute, the more will be the relative lowering of vapor pressure. Right? Because they both are directly proportional. Yes. The more the mole fraction of non-volatile solute, the more will be the relative lowering of vapor pressure. So, what can we say? Ma'am, we can say that the relative lowering of vapor pressure only and only depends on the amount of your solute. Non-volatile solute. It only depends on the amount of B, which is the non-volatile solute. If it is more, it will relative lowering would be more. If it is less, relative lowering would be less. Right? Yes. So, my dear students, relative lowering of vapor pressure is a colligative property. Okay? So, here we can say that this we've calculated doesn't depend on nature of the solute particles. I told you colligative properties do not depend on the nature of the particles. Colligative properties are the properties which depend on the number of particles, amount of particle, but not on the nature of the particles. Okay. Lowering of vapor pressure is a colligative property with respect to solute. Yes. And my dear students, relative lowering of vapor pressure is the colligative property with respect to solvent and solute both. Right? Yes. So, from here you understood that the properties which depend only and only on the amount, the number of moles, it is a colligative property. Right? Yes. Very good. So, you need to remember those expressions because questions are asked generally according to them. Now, we are going to talk about Henry's law. What is Henry's law? Everyone likes cold drinks? Yes, I think everyone likes cold drink, right? Yes. So, my dear students, if I ask you to drink the cold drink from a newly bought bottle, you'll find it taste amazing. Okay? Yes, ma'am. But if I ask you to just open and pour that in a very open container and just leave it for 10 minutes. After that, if you will drink, it will not taste good, right? Yes, it will feel like some sweet water, right? Yes, ma'am. So, what happened? You will say, ma'am, there was some gas. There was, ma'am, CO2, right? Yes. So, my dear students, Henry's law is applicable only when you have solute as gas and solvent as liquid phase. Okay, so Henry's law is applicable when a gas is mixed into a liquid. Okay, yes. Now, if you want to mix the gas into a liquid, imagine you have a container, something like this. There is a liquid here and you have some gas here. Now, if you want to mix this gas into this liquid solution, what will you do? You will apply pressure. Yes, ma'am. The more you apply the pressure, the more the gas would be soluble into this. Yes, ma'am. The more the pressure, the more the solubility. The more the pressure, the more the solubility. Yes, I can say that pressure is directly proportional to solubility of gas. Right? Yes, ma'am. You can say the more the pressure, the more would be the solubility. Now, if you are increasing the solubility, indirectly, what are you doing? You are increasing the mole fraction of that gas in the solution. Yes, ma'am. So, can I say that pressure is directly proportional to the mole fraction of that gas in the solution? Yes, ma'am. So, X of gas is the mole fraction of that gas in the solution. When you remove the proportionality, you get P is equal to KH into X of gas, where this KH is a Henry's constant. And my dear students, this Henry's constant has a particular value for every gas. This Henry's constant has a particular value for every gas. So, this is your Henry's expression. What does Henry say? Henry's law just says that as you increase the pressure, the solubility of the gas increases. Now, you know that we live in a world where the atmospheric pressure is constant, right? So, my dear students, imagine that P is equal to KH into X of gas. Now, I know that atmospheric pressure is constant. It means that when you are talking about a bottle of cold drink, its outer pressure is constant. You're not always just increasing the pressure. No, ma'am, its outer pressure is constant. Yes, this means that when this is constant, if you make the pressure constant, then what will happen? You know that now KH into X of gas should always be, their multiplication should always give a constant value. Imagine I am telling you that 4 into 4 is equal to 16. Now, I know that this 16 should remain fixed. Now, if I increase this 4 to 8, if I increase this 4 to 8 and I want this to be 16, then I have to decrease this number to 2. Yes. So, when the multiplication of some two numbers is constant, then if one is increasing, the other has to decrease, right? So, I can say that when this is constant, if X of gas, if your mole fraction of gas is increasing, then my dear students, the KH value will be decreasing. That is, I can say that if KH value of a gas is more, then its solubility would be less. So, this is how questions are asked. You are given a question in which you are given KH values of various gases. You are not supposed to remember them. You are given KH values and they ask which has a higher solubility. Then you will say the more the KH value, the less will be the solubility. Okay, and this is how you find out the solubility of various gases. Perfect. This is the first point. Second point is, how can you find the solubility? The gases which are more liquefiable are more soluble, right? So, gases more liquefiable are more soluble. Now, how will we find the gases which are more soluble? Ma'am, those gases are more soluble which have higher critical temperature. Here, you have to remember your states of matter chapter. The more the critical temperature, the more is the liquefiability. Okay? The more the van der Waals constant A value is the van der Waals constant A. The more its value is, the more liquefiable the gas is, the more will be the solubility, the less would be the Henry's constant. Okay, so from here you can find out that how are you going to calculate the solubilities, how are you going to compare the solubilities. Okay, yes, now let's read some points. Henry's law describes quantitatively the effect of pressure on the solubility of a gas. Clear, no issues. Next. KH does not depend on pressure. It is independent of pressure. It is a fixed value for every gas. It only and only depends on the temperature. But it depends on temperature and the nature of the gas and the nature of the liquid. Okay, very easy, very true thing. If a gas is CO2, then it will have a KH value different. If a gas is NO2, it will have a different value. right? Yes, the greater the Henry's law constant, the greater the KH value of the gas, the lesser will be the solubility. I think you know this, we have learned this, we have understood this, the more the KH value, the less will be the solubility. A gas with greater A value, A value is the van der Waals constant. If a gas has a greater A value, it is more liquefiable. If it is more liquefiable, its solubility is more. If its solubility is more, then its Henry's constant is less, right? So a gas with greater A value is more liquefiable and more soluble. It will have a lower value of Henry's law constant. Clear? Yes. When the temperature increases, Henry's law constant will increase. Okay? This I know that I am telling you Henry's law constant depends on temperature. When the temperature increases, Henry's law constant value also increases. Okay? Perfect. I hope you got this. If you want to write it, please write it. Okay. Perfect. Now we will move forward. Okay. Just a second. We are saving the things which we have studied, right? Yes. And then we'll move forward. Perfect. Let's move forward. Now we have a question, how to apply the concepts which we have just understood, right? Yes. First is KH value for various gases are given to you. Arrange these gases in the order of their increasing solubilities. Okay. So, ma'am, I know that more the KH value, lesser will be the solubility. So, let's see which of the following has the least KH value. Okay. Least KH value will have the highest solubility. Okay. Here the value is 0.143. Okay. This is minus 5. This is the least value. I guess this is the least value. Is this the least value? I'll write it. Okay. You have argon. You have CO2. You have HCHO. And you have CH4. What are the values? Let's see. You have 4.036. You have 1.67. You have 1.8. 3 into 10 power minus 5 and you have 0.143. So, if I see the least value is for HCHO. If the KH value of HCHO is least, then its solubility should be maximum. So, HCHO should have the maximum value. So, this cannot be the correct answer. This cannot be the correct answer. Now, let's see next value. Next, if we see, then CH4 has the second least value. So, CH4 should come here. So, ma'am, option C will be a correct answer. You just got your answer like this. Right? Yes, you just have to compare the KH values. I hope you got this concept. Yes, this is how you are asked questions. Let's move forward. Next question is on your screens. You have to answer the question. What is the question? Value of Henry's constant KH is increases with increase in temperature. Yes. Well, Henry's law constant depends on only on temperature. The more the temperature, the more will be the KH value, right? So, it increases with the increase in the temperature. So, option A is your correct answer. Let's move forward. Now, we have talked about ideal solutions, right? Yes, we've talked about ideal solutions. We've talked about non-ideal solutions. And we've talked about azeotropes. Now, we are going to do some questions on those as well. So, the question is on your screens. Just see the question and answer me. The first question is, if two liquids A and B form minimum boiling azeotropes at some specific composition, then. Now, my dear students, just imagine. If you have minimum boiling azeotrope. Minimum boiling azeotrope means, ma'am, less boiling point. Less boiling point means that volatility should be more, the vapor pressure should be more, and if we talk about more vapor pressure, then ma'am, it should show the further interactions should be less, the vapor pressure should be more. So ma'am, it should show positive deviation. It should show positive deviation. And when are positive deviations shown? When interactions after mixing are less than interactions before. Right? Yes. Now, let's see the options. AAB interactions are stronger than those of AA and BB. No, this is not the right option. Vapor pressure of solution increases Vapor pressure of the solution increases? Yes, because the more number of molecules of liquid A and B can escape from the solution. Yes, I think this is the right option. Let's see the other options as well. Vapor pressure of solution decreases. No, it does not decrease. It shows positive deviation. It should increase. AB interactions are weaker than those between AA or BB interactions. Yes, the correct answer is D. AB interactions are weaker than those between AA and BB. I think option D is correct. Now let's see the second option as well. Vapor pressure of solution increases. Vapor pressure of the solution, yes, which the solution, the vapor pressure will increase because more number of molecules of liquids A and B can escape from the solution. Yes, because their interaction would be less. So here, my dear students, it is a multi-correct question, and option B and D both are correct, right? So you don't have to just take one option and move forward. Check all the options and then find the correct answers. Okay, yes, so this was the correct option. These were the correct options. Let's move forward. Next question. What does the question say? Read the question and answer. Question says that for a dilute solution, Raoult's law states that. What does it state for a dilute solution? For a dilute solution, Raoult's law states that the lowering of vapor pressure is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. Okay, let's read all other options. The relative lowering of vapor pressure is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. The relative lowering of vapor pressure is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. Okay. I think the relative lowering of vapor pressure is proportional to the amount of solute in the solution. The vapor pressure of the solution is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. See, this option is not right. If we talk about the relative lowering, I know that delta P upon P A naught is equal to mole fraction of solute. So what do we say? That the relative lowering of vapor pressure, this was known as relative lowering. So relative lowering of vapor pressure is directly proportional to the, it is not directly proportional, it is equal to the mole fraction of that solute, right? Yes. So the relative lowering of vapor pressure is equal to the mole fraction of solute. Yes, option B is the correct answer. The lowering of vapor pressure is equal. No, it is not equal. If you see, lowering delta P is directly proportional to mole fraction of B. It is not equal to the mole fraction of solute. Okay. It is directly proportional, not equal. But relative lowering is equal to the mole fraction of the solute. Right. Yes. So option B will be your correct answer. Perfect. Let's move forward. Next question. What does the next question say? You have to read the question and answer me. The question says that when 1 mole of benzene is mixed with 1 mole of toluene, the vapor will contain. If you have 1 mole of benzene and you have 1 mole of toluene, my dear students, you know that you have both of the components in these 1 mole, 1 mole each, right? Now what you have to see, their vapor pressures, which has the vapor pressure of benzene is 12.8 and the vapor pressure of toluene is 3.85, right? So I can say that P benzene, pure vapor pressure of benzene is more than pure vapor pressure of toluene. Yes. Now, ma'am, when you talk about their amount, the one which has more vapor pressure, since both have 1 mole, 1 mole, so mole fraction of benzene would be 1 by 2 and mole fraction of toluene would be 1 by 2. Since mole fractions are equal, so the one which will have more pressure, vapor pressure, that will be in more amount, right? Yes, so benzene would be in more amount. I think you understand that will contribute more towards the vapor pressure. Yes, so ma'am, higher percentage of benzene would be there. So option C will be your correct answer. So option C would be your correct answer. Very good. So this is how you are going to answer these questions. Perfect. Let's move forward. Now we are going to talk about the elevation in boiling point. Now we are going to talk about the second colligative property, which is the elevation in boiling point. How are you going to study this? See, whenever you talk about the elevation in boiling point, how is this getting to, how are we going to understand this? Imagine, my dear students, you have a pure solvent. Pure A, okay. So you know that PA naught would be the vapor pressure of pure A, right? Yes, ma'am. Now let us say TB naught is the boiling point of pure A. No issues, no issues. Now, if you add some non-volatile solute to it, now you are adding some non-volatile solute B, non-volatile to it. Okay. Now, if you add a non-volatile solute to this solution, you know that, ma'am, PA would be less than PA naught. Yes. Now, my dear students, if the vapor pressure is less, then it will take more temperature. So that the atmospheric pressure is equal to the vapor pressure inside. Yes, I hope you remember that volatility is directly proportional to vapor pressure and it is inversely proportional to boiling point. Yes, so volatility is directly proportional to vapor pressure and it is inversely proportional to boiling point. This means that the one which will have more vapor pressure will have less boiling point, right? So if PA is less than PA naught, then TB will be more than TB naught. I hope you understand this. It will take more time, more temperature for the inner pressure to be equal to the atmospheric pressure. Yes, ma'am. So, my dear students, initially the pressure was TB naught and final was the TB pressure, which is more, right? Yes. So, what are you experiencing? You are experiencing the elevation in boiling point. Whenever a non-volatile solute is added to a pure solvent, we observe an elevation in boiling point. So, let us say delta TB is the elevation in boiling point and delta TB will be directly proportional. Delta TB would be directly proportional. This is elevation in boiling point. The more you will add the non-volatile solute, the more will be the elevation, the more difference would be there. Yes, ma'am. So, I can say it is directly proportional to the mole fraction of B. But, my dear students, here we use the term molality of B. Okay. Now, don't ask me this question, ma'am, why molality? But, my dear students, you have to understand this, that scientists used molality as a better concentration term to study the elevation and boiling point. Okay. So, they said that delta TB is directly proportional to molality of B. And when they removed the proportionality constant, then delta TB was equal to KB into MB, right? Where delta TB is the elevation in boiling point, KB is the constant and MB is the molality of the constant. So, we can write that delta TB is equal to KB into M, where M is the molality of solution and KB is very important. It is the molal elevation constant. It is also known as ebullioscopic constant. And you're not supposed to remember its values. It has different values for different solvents, solutions, and you are actually given KB value in the question. Okay, so elevation and boiling point is directly proportional to the mole fraction of the molality of the non-volatile solute. And when you remove the proportionality, you get KB, which is also known as molar elevation constant, or it is also known as ebullioscopic constant. Right? Yes. So you are asked questions according to this and you can answer very well. Perfect. Let's move forward. Next is elevation and boiling point. Now you can study the points. Boiling takes place when whole liquid and boiling point of a given pure liquid is constant only when external pressure is constant. Yes, the whole liquid is completely converted to vapor. The temperature remains constant under a constant external pressure. Perfect. Let's move forward. This we have studied. Now, we are given some questions, so we have to study these questions, right? Which of the following aqueous solution should have the highest boiling point? Okay, you cannot answer this question right now. I have to teach you Van't Hoff factor and then we'll come back to this question, okay? We'll study Van't Hoff factor and then you'll come back to this question. First, we will study about the depression and freezing point as well. It is very easy, exactly same like elevation and boiling point. In a depression and freezing point, when you add a non-volatile solute, the freezing point keeps on decreasing. The freezing point keeps on decreasing. So, if I say that TF is the freezing point of solution and TF naught is the freezing point of pure solvent, then and delta TF is depression in freezing point, then we know that delta TF would be directly proportional, delta TF would be directly proportional to the mole fraction of the solution, and delta TF will be equal to KF into M, where M is the molality and KF is a constant, and the values of KF are named as molar depression constant. It is also known as cryoscopic constant. You get the values, there's no issue, you will get different values of these cryoscopic constant for every solution, so you can write it like that, right? Yes. So it is exactly same like elevation and boiling point. There is a depression and freezing point. The more you add the non-volatile solute, the more there will be the depression and freezing point. Clear? Yes. Perfect. Now we have some questions which you are supposed to do. So here is the question. Try the question, my dear students. Read the question and try yourself. The freezing point of a solution containing 50 centimeter cube of ethylene glycol is 50 gram in 50 grams of water is found to be minus 34 degree Celsius. Okay. So my dear students, you can see that minus 34 degree Celsius is the depression, right? So total delta TF would be equal to 0 minus 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 34, which is equal to plus 34 degree Celsius. So you got your delta TF? Yes, perfect. Assuming ideal behavior, calculate the density of the ethylene glycol. You have to calculate the density of the ethylene glycol, and you are given KF for water, which is 1.86. Okay, so how are we going to do this question? I know that delta TF is equal to KF into molality, right? Yes. I am given the KF value, I am given the delta TF, so basically I have to find the molality. Right. Now, the freezing point of a solution containing 50 centimeter cube of ethylene glycol in 50 grams of water. So, my dear students, molality is moles of solute upon mass of solvent in kg. Okay. You have 50 centimeter cube of ethylene glycol, which is your solute. Okay. You have 50 centimeter cube of ethylene glycol in 50 grams of water. You have 50 grams of water as well. So you have the mass of solvent. You have the mass of solvent, but you don't have the mass of solute. So how are you going to find the mass of solute? See, we know that mass density is equal to mass by volume, right? Yes. So mass will be equal to density into volume. Clear? You are given volume, my dear students. So you can say let density is D, then the volume would be density into 50, right? Yes. So the mass of your solute would be 50 grams. What will be the moles of your solute? Molality would be equal to given mass 50 divided by molar mass of ethylene glycol. So you can find out the molar mass of ethylene glycol here, right? Yes, perfect. Just find out the molar mass of ethylene glycol divided by mass of your solvent in kg. What is your mass? Solvent? Ma'am, my solvent is water. So 50 divided by 1000 because mass is in kg. Right? Yes. So basically you only have D which is not known to you. Other all things you know. You know delta TF, you know KF. You know delta TF, you know KF. Now put this value in this, right, and solve, and you will get the density. Perfect. So this is how you are going to solve this question. This is how you are going to solve this question, right? Yes. So just understand what the question needs to know and you can solve the question. It is very easy. You just wrote it. Yes, you saw, you know delta TF, you know KF, but you don't know the molality. How are you going to find molality? Ma'am, just see ethylene glycol. See, it is saying that ethylene glycol is added to water. So water is your solvent. So 50 divided by 18, 50 is your solvent. So you want mass of your solvent in kg. So I took mass of solvent in kg. I am given 50 centimeter cube. I am given volume of my solute, but I don't have its mass, but I know that density is equal to mass by volume. So mass would be density into volume. Volume is given. Let us say density is D. So I calculated the density as this. And if I put all the things here, I'll get the answer, right? Yes. So since we have to cover the whole chapter, my dear students. So I'm not doing the calculations, but I am giving you the right method. So try to solve the question and answer it yourself. You can find the molar mass of ethylene glycol. I hope everyone knows that ethylene glycol. Now calculate the molar mass, put it here. You only have D, which you are not known, and if you will solve this, you will get the value of D. Do let me know in the comment section what is the value of D. Perfect. Density. Chalo, let's move forward. Now you have some paragraph questions. Now you have some paragraph questions. So we are going to solve some paragraph questions as well. So you can see the paragraph. Okay. I'll just the question. What type of deviation from the Raoult's law does the above graph represent? If we see the above graph, we are not shown any deviation right here. Right? Yes. Let's see. Read it. The partial pressure of each component of the solution is directly proportional to the mole fraction in this. Okay. Dalton's law of partial pressure states that the total pressure P total over the solution phase in the container will be the sum of the partial pressures of the components of the solution. So P total is this. So my dear students, I think there is some vapor pressure of solution. It is shown here. So this is the vapor pressure like this. Okay. The plot is something like this. Now tell me, my dear students, which deviation can you see? The pressure is less than expected from the Raoult's law. So, ma'am, it is showing negative deviation. So, it is showing negative deviation. So, option B will be your correct answer. Right? Let's move forward. Next question. Next question is, in comparison to 0.01 molar glucose, the depression and freezing point of this molar MG. Okay, my dear students, we have to do the Van 't Hoff factor part. Only then we can solve all these questions. So I think let's start the Van 't Hoff factor and then we'll come back to these questions. Okay. Yeah. So let me start the Van 't Hoff factor from here. Okay. Van 't Hoff factor. What is Van 't Hoff factor? My dear students, Van 't Hoff factor actually tells you that imagine you just added 1 mole of your solute. You will calculate everything according to 1 mole of your solute. But what if your solute just dissociates into the solution? Then you will have actually more number of moles than you actually calculated. Imagine I gave you a solution and I said you added 1 mole NaCl. You know that NaCl is a strong electrolyte. It will dissociate. Yes, ma'am. If NaCl got dissociated, then you will calculate as if you have added 1 mole of your solute. But actually in the solution, you will have moles of solute equal to moles of Na plus and moles of Cl minus, which is, ma'am, 2. So, but actual, you have 2 moles. But you calculated everything according to 1 mole. That is why we need a very important term, which is your Van 't Hoff factor. Van 't Hoff factor is represented by I. What does this say? This tells you that moles observed upon moles theoretical. Moles observed upon moles theoretical. Van 't Hoff factor only tells you the ratio of moles observed upon moles which were theoretical. Right? Yes. Imagine here, how many moles are observed? 2. But actually, there were only 1. So, here the Van 't Hoff factor would be 2 by 1, which is equal to 1. So, this is how you calculate the Van 't Hoff factor. So, now, you can calculate Van 't Hoff factor in 3 different ways. One, maybe the solute which you added got dissociated. Second, maybe the solute which you added got associated. Or third, the solute you added, it did not go and undergo any dissociation or association. Okay, so let's start. फर्स्ट केस डिसोसिएशन. इफ द सल्यूट आई एडेड गॉट डिसोसिएटेड वॉट विल हैपन? मैम यू हैड सम ए मोल्स एंड दे गॉट डिसोसिएटेड इन टू एन ए मोल्स, राइट? यस. सो इनिशियली यू हैड ओनली one mole and here you didn't have anything, and ma'am once the reaction took place, once the dissociation took place, let us say 1 minus alpha something got dissociated, then you will get n alpha moles. These were initial moles and these are final moles. Okay, so what will be your Van't Hoff factor? Here n total, my dear students, here n total would be equal to 1 minus alpha plus n alpha, which is 1 plus alpha n minus 1, right? Yes. And initially n total dash were equal to 1 only. So your Van't Hoff factor in case of dissociation would be how many moles were observed? How many moles were observed? 1 plus n minus 1 alpha. These were the moles which are observed. Yes, ma'am. So 1 plus n minus alpha. N minus 1 alpha. And how many you actually theoretically thought there would be? You only used one mole, na? So this would be 1. So I is equal to 1 plus n minus 1 alpha. So this is the formula in case of dissociation. If you are given alpha value. What is alpha? Alpha is the degree of dissociation. This is given in the question, degree of dissociation. So whatever alpha value is given, you just put it into it and you will get your Van't Hoff factor. Right? Yes. So this is how you find Van't Hoff factor in case of dissociation. Let's talk about the case when there is association. Right? In case of association. Case 2. Association. What will happen in association? You had a molecule. You had a molecule. It got associated and you got Na molecules you had, and you got A by, you got Na, An. You can write it like this. Right? Yes. It got associated. Initially, moles, you added 1. This was nothing. So here, N total would be equal to 1. Now, after some time, moles, after, let us say 1 minus alpha, right? Here, alpha is the degree of association. Degree of association. My dear students, this degree of association you have studied in equilibrium, okay? You have studied in equilibrium. So, this would be 1 minus alpha and this would be alpha by n. This would be alpha by n association. So here total moles would be equal to 1 minus alpha plus alpha by n. So we can say 1 plus alpha 1 by n minus 1. Right? Yes. So this is how you are going to calculate for association. So Van't Hoff factor would be n observed. What are these observed? These are observed. So 1 plus 1 by n minus 1 alpha divided by theoretically how many you added? Only 1. So this is how you will calculate your Van't Hoff factor for association. Right? What would be the third case? Case 3. No association. No association or dissociation. No association or dissociation. That means that your I will be equal to Van't Hoff factor would be equal to 1 by 1, which is equal to 1. There is no association, no dissociation. So what you observed was your theoretical value only. So it would be equal to 1, right? This is how you calculate association and dissociation. Van't Hoff factor, dissociation, Van't Hoff factor, and when there is no association or dissociation. Yes, ma'am. Now we are going to do the questions, because my dear students, the three colligative, yet you have studied three colligative properties. How are you going to use this Van't Hoff factor there? The first is relative lowering of vapor pressure. In relative lowering of vapor pressure, you had an expression where you said delta P by P is equal to mole fraction of your solute, right? So you can say delta P by PA naught is equal to moles of B upon moles of B plus moles of A, right? Here, what is the solute? Ma'am, A is the solute. So I, that is your Van't Hoff factor, will only be present with the moles of solute. So here I and here I. So this is the expression which you are going to use for the Van't Hoff factor. When you are supposed to calculate Van't Hoff factor, you will use the relative lowering expression, this, right? This is the first part. Second, elevation and boiling point. In elevation and boiling point, you know that the expression is delta Tf is equal to Kf into molality, where moles of solute, volume of moles of solute, mass of solvent in kg. Only one moles of solute is coming. So we can say that the expression would be, I would be here. So this is the expression for delta Tf is equal to IKFm when you are supposed to calculate Van't Hoff factor with elevation of boiling point, right? Similarly, third concept would be your depression in freezing point. Depression in freezing point. Now, we know the expression delta Tf is equal to Kf into M. So, if you are supposed to add Van't Hoff factor, so this would be here. So, this expression would be with the Van't Hoff factor. Now, if it is association, then you calculate the Van't Hoff factor according to the association. If it is dissociation, calculate according to the dissociation and put it into this and calculate. Easy, right? Yes, very good. Let's move forward. Now, we can do these questions. Now, ma'am will let you answer these questions. See, my dear students, in comparison to a 0.01 molar solution of glucose, see, glucose is a non-volatile, solute. Okay, it does not get associated, it does not get dissociated. So you can say that for glucose, Van't Hoff factor will be equal to 1. It does not get associated, does not get dissociated. The depression in freezing point of 0.01 molar MgCl2 solution is, now I am telling you that for glucose, it does not get associated, does not get dissociated, so Van't Hoff factor is 1. But for MgCl2, I know that MgCl2 dissociates into Mg2 plus and 2Cl minus. So how many ions it is getting dissociated into? 3. So my dear students, for this, Van't Hoff factor was 1 plus n minus 1 alpha. This is what we calculated. And here alpha value is 1 because it is getting completely dissociated. So I would be equal to 1 plus 3 minus 1 into 1. This is equal to 1 plus 2, which is equal to 3. So for MgCl2, your Van't Hoff factor value is 3. Okay. When you're not given any value for degree of dissociation, then you suppose it to be 1, that it is getting completely dissociated. When it is getting completely dissociated, you take alpha equal to 1. So you calculated it to be 3 value. Yes. So it said that which will have, what will be the depression in freezing point? So for glucose, I can say that delta Tf will be equal to IKF into M. So delta Tf will be equal to 1 into Kf into M. Right? Yes. Let's calculate for MgCl2. So for MgCl2, delta Tf will be equal to I value is 3. So ma'am, 3 into Kf into M. Here M value is given to be 0.01 for both. So M value is same for both. So we can say that it is 3 times of glucose. It is 3 times of glucose. So 3 times, about 3 times, option C would be your correct answer. This is how you are going to use the Van't Hoff factor concept. Okay, let's do some other questions to understand it more. Okay, we did all the questions. Yeah. Okay, there will be a lot of more questions as well, so don't worry. The question is, a solution of two liquids, both at temperature more than the boiling point of either of them, what type of deviation will be shown by the solution formed in terms of Raoult's law? If they have pressure more than the expected, this means that they are showing positive deviation. And if they are showing positive deviation, then the answer would be B, It is so easy, my dear students. Just understand the concept. You can answer all the questions. Okay, let's do the other question. Next question is, which of the following aqueous solution should have the highest boiling point? Which will have the highest boiling point? We know that we have elevation in boiling point, right? Yes, ma'am. Elevation in boiling point means that TB minus TB naught. This is equal to I into KB into M. Now you have to calculate the Wantoff factor for all. See, their concentrations 1, 1, 1, every concentration is same, so M value is same. Only the deciding factor would be Wantoff factor. Here, my dear students, since alpha value is not given, so you will calculate alpha to be 1. Wantoff factor will be 1 plus N minus 1 into alpha. Alpha is 1. So now see, NaOH, two ions. So here I value would be 2. Just calculate it yourself, it would be 2. Na2SO4, here your Wantoff factor would be 3. Just calculate it by this formula as well. Okay. NH4NO3, the Wantoff factor would be 2. And KNO3, Wantoff factor would be 2. Okay. Yes. So basically, what we can see that the higher boiling point would be for I is equal to 3. Yes, ma'am. So option B would be your correct answer. So this is how you are supposed to calculate the boiling points. This is how you are going to use the Wantoff factor concept. Okay. Yes, I hope you got it. Perfect. Okay, my dear students, you can understand this and then we'll move forward. Okay, I hope you have understood all this concept. Okay, now let's move forward. Next question. Okay, we are going to talk about osmotic pressure, but first I want you to solve those questions as well, which we just left. This question. Yes, solve this question. What is it saying? Which of the following aqueous solution should have the highest boiling point? Oh, we did this question. We did this question, ma'am. Option B was the correct answer, right? Yes. Next question. Next. Okay. Which one of the following solution in water has highest boiling point? Highest boiling point. Right? Yes. So let's see. Again, I know that delta TB minus TB naught is equal to I into KB into M. And I know that every molality is nearly same. Beta, molality is nearly equal to molarity. So where I am taking M equal to M, just understand that it is one and the same things. KB value is same. So the deciding factor is I. The more the I value, the more would be the delta TB value. Okay, so you have to find what? Wantoff factor I. So here Wantoff factor is 2, ma'am. Here Wantoff factor is 3, ma'am. Here the Wantoff factor would be 1. For urea it is 1. For glucose it is 1. Why? Because these are organic compounds. Okay, so the maximum I value is for B. So ma'am, option B will be our correct answer, right? This is how you are going to solve the questions. And see, Wantoff factor questions are so easy. Yes, I hope you got the concept. Very good. Let's move forward. Now we can move forward because we have solved all the questions. Okay. Now, my dear students, we are going to discuss about osmotic pressure. Now we are going to talk about osmotic pressure. What is osmotic pressure? OP, the favorite word of every student, OP, right? Yes, so ma'am will write it here. OP. This is what OP stands for, osmotic pressure. Okay, my dear students, and osmotic pressure is given by the symbol pi. What is osmotic pressure? I'll make you understand right now, right? Don't read this. First, understand what I want to tell you. Imagine you have this container. Okay, you have this container and there is a semi-permeable membrane. What is this? This is a semi-permeable membrane. It only allows the movement of solvent and does not allow the movement of your solute. Okay. Only solvent can move, solute cannot move. Okay. Now, imagine you have pure A here and here you have A plus B solution. Okay. So, A is your solvent and B is your solute. Now, here is some open area, some open area. Okay. Perfect. I hope you got it. Now, my dear students, you have to understand this. You have to understand this, that always and always the movement is from more volume to less volume. You can write it, movement is from more volume to less volume. So we see that pure A has more volume than B, right? Than the solution. Yes, ma'am, pure A has more volume here than the solution, right? Yes. So the movement would be from this side to this side. So this is how the pure A would try to move towards the solution. Okay. Now, when this movement will take place, some pressure will be exerted here. Some pressure would be exerted here. This pressure is known as the osmotic pressure. This pressure exerted is known as the osmotic pressure. This pressure is supposed to be called as osmotic pressure. First definition. What is the first definition? When pure A moves towards the solution, the pressure exerted by the pure A solvent is known as the osmotic pressure. First definition. Second definition. Imagine some P pressure is being applied and the particles are moving forward. Now, if you are applying some pressure, but you want to stop this movement, what will you do? You will apply equal pressure from the opposite side, then the particles will stop. If you applied even more pressure, the particles would go backward. But if you apply equal pressure, the pressure exerted by them, then they can stop. Right? Yes. So, my dear student, what happens if we apply some P pressure from this side equal to the osmotic pressure so that the movement of pure A is stopped? This P pressure would also be called as osmotic pressure. Right? Because it would be exactly same to the pressure exerted by them. Yes, ma'am. So, you have two definitions of osmotic pressure. The first definition is the pressure exerted when a pure solvent moves towards the solution side, that pressure is known as osmotic pressure. Second definition would be the pressure exerted so that you can stop the movement of pure solvent A is known as the osmotic pressure. Both the definitions are actually, they mean the same, but they are two different definitions. So, I just wanted to make you explain them. Okay. So, now you can read this. What is it saying? When membrane is permeable to solvent particles but impermeable to the solute particles, they are called semi-permeable membrane. Solvent can pass through, but solute can't. Okay. This is what it is explained. Perfect. Next, move forward. Osmosis. And this process is known as osmosis. Okay. I told you osmotic pressure, but this whole process is known as osmosis. Now, study this osmosis pressure. Movement of solvent molecules, the pure solvent molecules, through the semi-permeable membrane from the pure solvent, that is pure A, side to the solution side, from less concentration to more concentration solution. Right? Yes. Osmotic pressure is the now you can understand the definition of osmotic pressure, which I told you. Osmotic pressure is the hydrostatic pressure built up or the solution side due to the osmosis from pure solvent side to the solution side. Okay? Yes. A concentrated solution containing non-volatile solute will have greater osmotic pressure but lower vapor pressure. Right? Yes. So, I hope you understood this concept. What is osmosis? The movement of pure solvent A towards the solution side. Right? Yes. And what is osmotic pressure? The pressure exerted by the pure solvent A is known as the osmotic pressure, or the pressure applied from there to stop the movement of pure solution A is also known as the osmotic pressure. Right? Yes. So, this is very important. Okay? Perfect. And this whole process is known as osmosis. Perfect. Let's move forward. Next is alternative definition, my dear students, of osmotic pressure. Exact pressure to be applied on the solution side in a perpendicular direction so as to stop the osmosis from pure solvent side. Okay. Now, if the pressure applied, now the other condition, you applied this pressure, the pressure was getting applied from this side, they were stopped. Okay. If I apply even more pressure, what will happen? If I apply even more pressure, the particles would move backward. Now, what will happen? The same condition, my dear students, which was here. If you apply some P pressure, which is more than the osmotic pressure, what will happen? Ma'am, this solution side would start moving to this side. If you apply even more pressure, then the solution side will start moving towards the pure solvent A. Yes, because you are applying even more pressure. This is what is known as reverse osmosis. Opposite of osmosis will be reverse osmosis. Okay, now let's see. If pressure applied on the solution side is greater than the osmotic pressure of the solution, the solvent will flow from the solution side to the pure solvent side, and it is known as reverse osmosis. And a very important thing to tell you, that reverse osmosis is the actual way of purifying water. The ROs we use at home are doing this concept. What are they doing? They are applying pressure greater than the osmotic pressure. They are applying pressure greater than the osmotic pressure, and as a result, what is happening? The impure water is going towards the pure water side, and they have semi-permeable membrane which stops the impurities, and you get only and only pure water. So this is how reverse osmosis takes place. Okay, yes, so I hope you got this concept. Whenever you will apply even more pressure than the osmotic pressure, it will start moving this side, and you will get more and more of pure water A. Two solutions having osmotic pressure equal are known as isotonic solutions. Now, if I have two solutions and both of them have equal osmotic pressure, I will call them as isotonic solutions. How are we going to define, how are we going to tell you that osmotic pressure is equal to? My dear students, the formula of osmotic pressure is CRT, where C stands for the concentration of solution, R stands for the gas constant, and T stands for the temperature, and pi is your osmotic pressure. Okay, I hope you got it. So this is the expression for osmotic pressure. Now, if you are using a Van 't Hoff factor, then pi is equal to ICRT. This is the expression for the Van 't Hoff factor, osmotic pressure. Clear? Yes. So I hope you got the concept. I hope you got the concept of osmotic pressure. I hope you got the concept of osmosis. I hope you got the concept of reverse osmosis. I hope you got the concept of the working of ROs in our homes. Right? Yes. Very good. So this is how we are going to finish this topic. So basically, we have completed all the solutions topics, my dear students. Only these topics are in your liquid solution chapter, which we have discussed, but now we are supposed to apply them. We are supposed to practice a lot of questions, right? So let's apply them and learn even more different ways of solving questions. Okay, let's start. Okay, so here is the question. Just read the question and answer yourself. What does the question say? Consider the figure and mark the correct option. Okay, you have A, where it is fresh water, and you have concentrated sodium chloride solution water, which is impure. Basically, you have to pure it. You have to turn it into a pure water. How will you do? You will apply some P pressure, which would be more than the osmotic pressure. If you will apply some pressure which is more than the osmotic pressure, then these particles would start moving this side. Yes. So now let's read these. Water will move from side A to side B. Fresh water will move from side A to side B if the pressure is lower than the osmotic pressure applied on piston. Yes. Yes. If some pressure is applied which is less than the osmotic pressure, then this means that you are moving forward and somebody is applying pressure, but it is less than the osmotic pressure. So you can push him, right? Yes. So yes, ma'am, A will keep on moving towards the B side. So first statement is correct. Mark the correct option. So ma'am, this statement is correct. Let's see the second statement. Water will move from side B to side A. Water will move from this side to this side if pressure is greater than the osmotic pressure applied on the piston. Yes, it is also right. If you apply P pressure, which is more than the osmotic pressure, then water will move that side. Yes, ma'am, this statement is also correct. Let's see the third statement. Water will move from side B to side A if pressure is equal to the osmotic pressure applied. No, if the pressure is equal to the osmotic pressure, then movement will stop, but it will not move towards that side. Okay. Fourth statement, water will move from side A to side B if pressure is equal to the osmotic pressure. No, if pressure is equal, then it will not move. So we got two options correct, which is option A and option B. Right? Yes. This is how you are going to solve the questions. Let's move forward to the next question. What does the next question say? Next question says that identify which of the following is a colligative property. You have to tell which of the following is a colligative property. What are colligative properties? The properties which only and only depend upon the amount of your solute. Right? Yes. Or we would say which depends only and only on the amount. Right? Yes. So, ma'am, freezing point, yes, it depends on the amount. Freezing point, what is freezing point? Freezing point is whenever you will increase the non-volatile solute, the freezing point will decrease. So, depression freezing point, yes, it depends on the amount. Boiling point, elevation in boiling point, yes, ma'am, this depends upon the amount. If you talk about osmotic pressure, yes, it depends on the amount. The more the non-volatile solute, the less would be the pressure. Yes, ma'am. So option D, that is all of the above, is your correct answer. Right? Yes. Here you can write the expressions. Delta TF is equal to I into KF into M. Delta TB is equal to I into KB into M. And pi is equal to I, C, R and T. Right? Perfect. Let's move forward. Next question. Van 't Hoff factor we have discussed, right? So we can leave this concept. Now you have to solve this question. Read this question and try yourself. Pause the video and do on your own. The question says, if a solvent n simple molecules of solute combine to form an association. So my dear students, there is association, and where x is the degree of association. So this time x is your degree of association. X is your degree of association, right? Yes, the Van 't Hoff factor is very easy. You have, what do you have? I had Na molecules which got associated and I got An. Initially, I had one mole, I didn't have anything. Then I had 1 minus alpha, so I had alpha by N molecules. So, my Van 't Hoff factor would be total moles which are observed 1 minus alpha plus alpha by N. So, 1 minus alpha plus alpha by N upon which was theoretical, which was 1. So, this would be equal to 1 minus. Now, it said that x is the degree of dissociation, association, not alpha. So, instead of alpha, put x. Alpha is equal to x. So, 1 minus x plus x by n. So, 1 minus x plus x by n. Ma'am, option C, that is third, is your correct answer. Right? Yes. Let's move forward. Next question, my dear students. Next question. Osmotic pressure of a sugar solution at 24 degrees Celsius. So, T is 24 degrees Celsius. We have to convert it into Kelvin. So, this is 7, 7, 8, 9 and 2. 298 Kelvin. Okay. Yes. So, osmotic pressure of a sugar solution at 24 degrees Celsius is 2.5 atmosphere. So, pi is given as 2.5 atmosphere. Determine the concentration of the solution in mole per liter. So, basically, you have to calculate C. So, you know that, and it is given for pressure sugar solution. My dear students, sugar solution does not associate or dissociate. So, we can say that Van 't Hoff factor would be 1, right? So, pi is equal to I C R T. I is 1, C we have to calculate. R value would be how much? Since you are using pressure to be 2.5 atmosphere, so my dear students, your R value would be 0.0821 into temperature, which is 297, right? Yes. So, pi is given as 2.5. So, just calculate and you will get your C value. C would be equal to 2.5 upon 0.0821 into 297. So, this is how you will get your concentration, and this concentration will be in mole per liter. This will be in mole per liter. Clear? Yes. Let's move forward. Next question. Next question is, just let me know which is the correct answer, okay? You only are supposed to do the calculations. Vapor pressure of a solvent containing non-volatile solute is. Now, if you have a solvent and you added some non-volatile solute, then what will happen? Its vapor pressure will मैम इट्स वेपर प्रेशर विल डिक्रीज. यस बच्चे, वी हैव डिस्कस दिस द होल लेक्चर दैट वेन एवर यू एड नॉन वोलेटाइल सल्यूट इट कॉजेज हिंड्रेंस फॉर द प्योर सॉल्वेंट मॉलिक्यूल्स टू गो इन टू द वेपर फेज, राइट? यस, सो द टोटल प्रेशर वुड डिक्रीज, सो लेस द वेपर प्रेशर ऑफ सॉल्वेंट, less than the vapor pressure of solvent, right? Yes, I hope you answered it correct, option B. Let's move forward. Next question is on your screen. What does this question say? The boiling point of C6H6, there are four gases and you are given their boiling points, which will show highest vapor pressure at room temperature. First of all, we will write all the gases. C6H6, CH3OH, C6H5NH2, and C6H5NO2. Right? Yes. What are their boiling points? Their boiling points are 80 degrees Celsius, 65 degrees Celsius, 184 degrees Celsius, and 212 degrees Celsius. They are asking you that which will show highest vapor pressure. Highest vapor pressure means lowest boiling point. Always remember that if some gas has very high vapor pressure, then its boiling point will be less because it will turn into vapor very fast and the pressure would be equal to the atmospheric pressure at very low temperature. So, vapor pressure is inversely proportional to boiling point. So, if you want highest vapor pressure, then you need to see the lowest boiling point. Lowest boiling point is for C6H6, which is 80 degrees Celsius. So C6H6, option A would be your correct answer, right? Yes, let's move forward. Next question, my dear students. Next question is here. Just answer the question. A solution of sulfuric acid in water exhibits. A solution of sulfuric acid in water actually shows you hydrogen bonding, even more stronger hydrogen bonding after mixing, right? H2SO4 and water shows even higher, stronger hydrogen bonding after mixing. This means that I can say that AB interactions will be more than AA interaction or BB interaction. This means that the vapor pressure would be even less than the expected. So, this will give me negative deviation. So, ma'am, negative deviation, option A would be my correct answer, right? Yes. So, let's move forward. Next question, my dear students. Next is, which of the following is not for ideal solution? Which of the following is not true for ideal solution? Raoult's law is obeyed by the entire concentration range at temperature. Yes, any solution, any solvent which will follow Raoult's law at all concentrations at all temperatures is actually known as a true solution, ideal solution. So, this statement is correct. Delta H mixing should be 0 because all the interactions should be equal. Delta V mixing should be equal to 0. Again, we know that. But my dear students, delta S mixing should not be equal to 0. Delta S mixing is always a positive value because it is randomness, and a randomness of a mixture is always positive, right? That Ball's example you have to remember, and you will say that option B is the correct answer. This is wrong. It should always be positive, right? Yes, perfect. Next, move forward. Next question, which of the following condition is not correct for ideal solution? Which of the following condition is not true? Let's answer this question. No change in volume on mixing. This means that for a true solution, delta V mixing should be equal to 0. This is correct. No enthalpy change on mixing. That means delta H mixing should be equal to 0. This is also correct. It obeys Raoult's law. Yes, obviously it obeys Raoult's law. Ionization of solute should occur on a small extent. There is nothing like this said in the Raoult's law. So, option D would be your correct answer. Right? Yes. Very easy. Perfect. Let's move forward. Next question is, which of the following is not a colligative property? You have to tell which of the following is not a colligative property. Delta TF is depression in freezing point. It is a colligative property. Delta TB is elevation in boiling point. It is a colligative property. Pi is your osmotic pressure. It is a colligative property. But KB is a constant. It is not a colligative property. Right? So, option D is your correct answer. Let's move forward. Next question. On passing of a solvent particle through semi-permeable membrane is called, passing of only the solvent particle through osmotic pressure is known as osmosis. Through a semi-permeable membrane is known as osmosis. So, option A will be your correct answer, right? Yes, very easy questions, right? Yes, you are asked only these questions. So don't worry, it is very easy, and if you know the concept, you can do everything. In the case of osmosis, solvent molecules move from, in the case of osmosis, it is not asking reverse osmosis. Osmosis, in osmosis, it goes from pure solvent to solution side, from higher vapor pressure to lower vapor pressure. See, pure solvent has a higher vapor pressure, I know that, and the solution has lower vapor pressure. You know that when you add a non-volatile solute. Yes, so ma'am, this statement is right. Indirectly it is telling you from pure solvent to the solution side. Higher concentration to lower concentration, no, right? Lower vapor pressure to higher, no. Higher osmotic pressure to lower osmotic pressure, no, right? So option A is your correct answer. Let's move forward. Next question. Okay, now you have some assertion and reason concepts. So you have to give this assertion and reason correct. Is it true or not? Is it the right explanation or not? Let's see. First is, the molarity of the solution changes with temperature. Does molarity change with temperature? Molarity is moles of solute upon volume of solution in liters. And we saw that temperature, volume is temperature dependent, but mass is not temperature dependent. So if temperature changes, volume changes. So molarity changes. So molarity of the solution changes with temperature. Yes, this statement is true. Let's see the second statement. Molarity is a colligative property with respect to solute. If we talk about molarity, it is moles of solute upon volume of solution in liters, right? Yes. So if the amount of solute changes, then will your molarity change? Yes, ma'am. So yes, my dear students, it is a colligative property with respect to solute. Yes, ma'am, this is true. So this statement is also true. But is this statement the right explanation for the assertion? No. So we would say that statement 2 is not correct explanation of statement 1. They both are true, yes, but it is not the correct explanation. But it is not the correct explanation. Why is it not the correct explanation? See, if the statement 2 would have been that volume is temperature dependent, then that would be the correct explanation. But second statement is not telling you anything about the solvent. It is only talking about the solute. And yes, statement 2 is correct. It is a colligative property with respect to solute. Why? It only depends on the moles of the solute, and solute mole changes, molarity would change. So it is a colligative property with respect to solute, but it is not the correct explanation for the statement 1, right? Yes. So I hope you got this. Very good, very good. And with this, we have came to the end of our session, right? Yes. So I hope you enjoyed today's session. I enjoyed a lot. Yes, we have studied so many things, we have practiced so many questions, my dear students, and I hope all of you enjoyed, you actually benefited from it. So thank you so much for watching this. If you are still here, this means that you actually are determined and you actually are understanding everything which I am trying to give you here. So thank you so much. It means a lot. And do let me know in the comment section that how was this lecture, what other things you want. I'll definitely try to incorporate those in the next sessions. So keep studying like this. Thank you so much. Bye bye. Take care. All the very best.